is a presentation of Fox Sports.
This is the place, Rockingham, North Carolina, where grassroots racing was brought up to speed on a track known as The Rock. And the fans that have come here have weathered through a rough weekend, rain washing out any hour on Saturday. They have the Cameron Crazies nearby at Duke, but these are race fan fanatics making this their home the past 5 days, coming out to see drivers like Michael Waltrip, 0 for 34 here, but coming off another Daytona 500 win. And Kevin Harvick, making Richard Childress Racing proud, a fourth-place finish at Daytona, hoping for a bounce-back season. Tony Stewart finishing seventh at Daytona this year after winding up last the previous year. The points champ needing another strong race on this track, a track that he's always done well on. Those are just some of the drivers ready to rumble over this rugged raceway where they can see clearly now. Fox Sports welcomes you to the North Carolina Speedway and the Napa Free Race Show, brought to you by Napa Auto Parts, coming to you from Rockingham, located in the southeastern part of the Tar Heel State. They've been coming here since the mid-60s on a one-mile track that allows you to run high and run low and run to a great finish as you see the guys getting ready to go. And we welcome you to the Hollywood Hotel, located near Victory Lane, where we try and take you to where the races are and bring you a little bit closer to the action. Hi, I'm Chris Myers, and glad to have you with us here on the Napa Auto Parts Pre-Race Show. This is the first race of the rest of the Winston Cup season. In the wake of the Daytona 500, drivers return to their racing roots on a track where the result is more in the hands of the guy behind the wheel. Dave Blaney on the pole for today's 400-mile race, which features past winners like Jeff Gordon and Mark Martin. But before we go full speed ahead, let's glance back a bit with our crew here, Jeff Hammond and Darrell Waltrip, and the Daytona 500, and congratulations on brother Michael winning the big race. He now has two. You have one, Daytona.
Well, I know that, but listen, my brother's run, he's always run well down there. He drove the 30 Pennzoil car down there. He always ran well in that car, in the 21 car for the Wood Brothers. Almost won down there a couple of times, and now he's in the DEI equipment, which is superior to kind of everybody else's. He wins his second Daytona 500 and his third win at that Speedway.
All right, but Jeff, can a guy, can a crew, can they leave it and put so much into that race that it affects them here as they try and get going?
Chris, I think we've seen in the past that a lot of times that does happen. You put so much focus in that race, and when you win it, you're so excited, you get off track a little bit. So these guys got to come in and refocus what's going on.
All right, let's get back on track. Take a look back at the rain-shortened Daytona 500 and a great crowd, 200,000 people hurrying in to see the race. Jeff Green started on the pole but never led. And Ryan Newman ended up 43rd after crashing here on lap 57. Ward Burton involved, Labonte, Ken Schrader. And, you know, Darrell, what's going through the driver's mind when his car is doing this? You've experienced something similar.
Well, you have a lot of thoughts. First of all, you think about, I'm out of the race. The next thing you wake up and you say, yippee, that was quite a ride, and I'm still alive.
I somehow made it through.
Yeah, it really does. And as a crew chief, you're standing in a pit here and you're seeing this happening. You're sitting here. I mean, it just scares you to death because you don't know how bad your driver's hurt. And that's, I mean, that's kind of like your first thing. That's my man right there. And is he okay?
It was amazing that Ryan Newman said and spoke with us afterwards that he just had a little sod in his lap. And the car is supposed to come apart like that. It actually protects the driver.
Yeah, the car flying apart, it dissipates energy. Those kind of wrecks are never as bad as they look. And the ones that are not so bad are the ones that hurt you.
And then Michael Waltrip taking the lead the final time here and led 68 laps to win.
Right here, you know, if Christian Fittipaldi had been up there behind Dale Jr., Michael could have never made that move. But it worked out perfectly for him. And, Jeff, he went right for it.
He really did. He saw the hole. He knew what he had to do. Dropped in right behind Dale Earnhardt Jr. right there. And that was the move for the win right there. I mean, what more can you say? Great move. Great win.
And after the rain delay, they announce it, and Michael, his second Daytona 500 title and all the rewards that come with it. But let's put this question out there because fans talked about it. It was really only the third time that we had a rain-shortened Daytona 500 in 45 years of the race. And I'll start with you. Because it is the great American race, it pays the most money, and you have the most time to get ready for it, should they make sure that they break up that going halfway and complete the 500 miles?
Well, we put so much emphasis on the Daytona 500. Why not? Let's look at the big picture. We had almost 30 million fans looking at it, feeling like they got cheated. Now, I understand the rule's the rule, but maybe we need to step back and consider changing the rule for Daytona and Daytona only. What do you think, driver?
Well, let me tell you something here, my old friend.
Okay.
You remind me of somebody moved into the neighborhood and they want to change the neighborhood, you know? You got to adapt to what you got. The rules are the rules. It's the Daytona 500. Yeah, it's the biggest race we have. But, my friend, you can't have a knee-jerk reaction every time something doesn't go the way you want it to. I get tired of people wanting to change the rules all the time.
We're in a new era, though, of fans watching
the race. You tell me to open my mind and be open-minded about things. That's all I'm saying.
All right.
Consider it.
Well, I'm just like the guy in Fiddler on the Roof. Tradition.
All right, we have one for, one against. We'll let NASCAR settle the issue. All right, let's talk about today's race. And last week was all about fuel cells. This is going to be all about tires.
It really is, Chris. Today, forget about running out of gas because you're going to run out of tires first, and it's, you know, about 70, 75 laps, you're going to be hunting for tires.
And take me through. I keep hearing about the high groove here.
Here's what happens. When you get that baby down on the bottom and you got that wheel cranked to the left and you're running that throttle and you're grinding on that right front tire, and that right front tire goes away, what are you going to do? You're going to have to go high.
Yep.
You find you a higher groove to run. This track has a lot of different places you can run. Run around the bottom like
here's
this.
An illustration.
Here's a 17 car. Watch. He's on the white line. He makes a pass on Sterling Marlin to take the lead.
But, Darrell, at the same time, this racetrack affords you an opportunity, if you want to go high. Watch Jeff Gordon right here. He's going in on a high side and let the car go up. He makes a clean move right there on Martin down on the bottom side.
And it's not a driver. It's not like the driver is doing that because he wants to. The car dictates where you go.
Yeah, and drivers, they'll use more sets of tires in today's race than the people at home will on their car, what they'd use in 10 or 12 years. And one guy who knows something about this racetrack is with our Dick Berger. And Mark Martin has won here 13 times. Dick?
Thanks, Chris. Mark, what's the secret to your success here?
Going through the corners fast. You know, it's about the same as everywhere else, but it just is easier for me. On the high bank 1 mile racetracks here in Dover are probably my very, you know, favorite.
Why do so many people have so much trouble with this place?
Oh, this place is it eats the tires up, and you can't get a good practice. I mean, you have to put new tires on every time you make a change in order to really know what you have. And that means if you come to test here, it's 10 to 15 sets of tires. And then, even then, you know, you get just wore out running 25 to 40 laps, and you need to run more like 60 or 70. And you just run out of time and tires and everything else, you know, and energy. It's a real tough place to get it right at, and once you get it right, you can ride that wave for a while.
That from the master at this place, to Jeannie Zelasco.
Well, thanks. After 112 Winston Cup starts, Dave Blaney finally has the pole. What's it feel like to have the best seat in the house?
Yeah, it's about time, huh? One for 112, isn't that good? It feels good. I'm real proud of our whole Jasper team. This is one of the first new cars that my new guys have built from the ground up, so it's felt great all weekend. Wish we'd had a little more practice with it, but everybody's in that same boat. So, I mean, we'll go in here same as we do every week, looking, you know, trying to get a top 10 car, you know, in the first part of the race and then finish it off, and we'll see what happens.
Well, you got your first pole. You know what's next? Your first win, Chris.
And, you know, Blaney has really benefited, he said, from his crew chief, first time they're together, Booty Barker. And he's a guy, in case people aren't aware, who is confined to a wheelchair, but still obviously does his job and does it well. Talk about their chemistry, Jeff.
Well, right off the bat right now, you got to realize Booty Barker has worked with the likes of Scott Wimmer and Jeff Gordon. He's learned a lot about how to make a team work and be successful. And everywhere he's gone, he always brings that attitude of, I'm going to get the job done. And I think it's what Booty's done. He's given Dave Blaney a little shot of I guess you might say, confidence, yeah. And it shows.
But just think, Chris, you're in the shop working and your crew chief rolls in his wheelchair and he's confined to his wheelchair and he looks at your team. I mean, that's motivation.
Yeah, it has
to. I mean,
to.
The leader, he looks at me and says, I'm in a wheelchair. What's your excuse?
Yeah, that has to be a terrific inspiration for Blaney, who has done a terrific job and hopes to win his first Winston Cup race. Benson won his first Cup race on this track in the fall, and it took Benson 7 seasons to experience victory lane. And now he's starting on the front row with Blaney, and he is standing by with our Steve Burns.
Chris, that victory was the first in 226 Winston Cup starts for Johnny Benson. Does that give you the confidence to win here again today?
Well, we're obviously looking forward to the race getting going, and you know, you never know. I mean, I think that there's been a lot of races that we've been so close to winning. It was great to win our first one here at Rockingham, and it'd be nice to do it again.
Why do you like this place, Johnny?
You know, you get to ask that a lot, but it's a type of racetrack. You slip and slide. You slide around, and it's got a lot of grooves. You can go different places. So if your car's not working in one particular spot, you can move around on a track and try to find a place that does work good. And I think that part's key, because you get to a one-groove racetrack and your car doesn't work very good, you're in trouble. But here you can move around and make some adjustments, go from there.
Good luck. Johnny Benson starts second, and we go to Matt Yoakum.
Steve, for the second straight year, Kurt Busch enters Rockingham fourth or better in points. He finished third here last fall, leading 105 laps. But we have a big unknown. No final practice session. How does that shake up your strategy?
Well, we look at it in a lot of different ways. And we've changed 4 springs since that fall race, just because of the new aero package that we have. And we've got our balance that we think we need. We left 4 shocks on the car just to leave that alone. So there's so many things we wanted to change. We didn't have time to work on it. And so you've got to weigh it out, what's important, what's not important. And so obviously pit strategy here is a given. 4 tires every time you come in. We shouldn't have many problems on pit road with the better brakes on the cars. People get able to get in and out of their pit boxes. And you're not having to race everybody on pit road to beat somebody. You can pass here. You can run high, you can run low. And so, you know, Mark's got a good car. Matt Kenseth's got a great car. If we can beat a third Roush car today and finish third, that'd be fine. But we're shooting for the win. We want to get on top of these points and keep going.
The Roush car's always stout here at the Rock. Kurt Busch trying to become the 9th different Rockingham winner in the last 9 Rockingham races. Chris?
All right, thanks, guys. And at age 24, Kurt Busch heading home to Las Vegas next week and hopes to go there on a winning note, as you see Jeff Gordon and some of the other drivers being introduced as we head closer to the start of the race. Coming up, we're going to hear from Ryan Newman and this year's rookie class. You wouldn't believe what the old school is doing to the new school. It's ahead on the Napa Auto Parts pre-race show. And welcome back to the Napa pre-race show, coming to you from Rockingham, North Carolina. There's Mr. Napa. And the track called The Rock, and the famous Big Rock here located at the entrance of the Speedway. And the rock is made of crushed granite, weighs 41,000 pounds. And if you win a Winston Cup race here, your name is engraved on the rock. As you see a number of, hey, there's DW. I think he wrote that one. He wrote that one in on his way in. No, he, of course, had success here. Part of tradition and breaking tradition, NASCAR will welcome a new competitor to the Craftsman Truck Series. Toyota trucks will start racing in 2004. The Toyota Tundra trucks that will be racing in the series are made in America. You can catch the entire truck series, by the way. It's new home on Speed Channel. And at Daytona, the truck series, a dramatic finish. Rick Crawford, the daring last lap pass to claim victory in what was the first race of the season. And let me just first ask this, Jeff, with Toyota, how long before they're actually racing in the Winston Cup Series?
Well, Chris, in my estimation right now, they'll spend a couple years in the Craftsman Truck Series, much like Dodge did, get their engine program worked out and then kind of work on their car program and figure out who's going to be kind of like carrying the Toyota colors. About 2006, I think, he'll be making a move up to Winston Cup.
And how about Toyota in trucks? How will it affect things?
Yeah, well, I think it's a great move by NASCAR. I mean, let's face it, folks, our economy today is global. I mean, we got fingers all over the world. And so I think it's well overdue. These trucks are made in America, and I think there'll be maybe it'll open the door for other foreign makes to come in, but they're really not foreign makes, and I think it's good for the sport.
Because and you're only going to be driving in the truck series
as long as they've made our rules. That's what matters.
Yeah, they got a lot of work to do, but it'll be good for the sport. It'll be good for the truck series.
And the truck series has produced, graduated such stars as Kevin Harvick and Kurt Busch, Greg Biffle, and there are six Winston Cup rookies that are starting today's race. So let's get your thoughts on that of the guys. Anybody jump out, stand out that you think in the big picture will have a terrific year?
Well, right now, I'd have to go right to begin with is Jamie McMurray. Jumps in that car last year for Sterling Marlin, wins his first Winston Cup race. I believe this team is on a poised for, you know, greatness. I think they're going to have a really solid run this year. What do you think?
Well, I like Greg Biffle, and I tell you why. I mean, I look at records, and I look at numbers, and if you look at him, he's won the Truck Series Championship. Right. He moved up to Busch. He won the Busch Series Championship. Can he win the Winston Cup Championship? You look at the Rouse organization right now, he could very well be a contender before the year's over.
Yeah, if you say, why not? Well, this year's rookie crop includes a Foyt and a Mears, names that are synonymous with winning. But no matter what your family background, all rookies must endure a crazy and hazing first season.
Hey, Jack, give me a beer, would you?
Yes, Rusty.
You know, I'll tell you what's on my mind, and sometimes that's hurt me, but now it's like everybody wants to hear what's on your mind, and that's respectful now, but 10 years ago when I was doing it, it wasn't cool.
Tony, you get that countertop right.
I'm working on it.
I decided when I got an opportunity to run a Winston Cup that I was going to enjoy it no matter what happens, because this is an opportunity that I've wanted all my life, and I'm going to do the best I can and let the chips fall where they may.
Larry, how's it looking back there?
Thick and span, Rusty. It's going to be real nice for you.
All right, buddy.
I went from my dad being totally against me racing to, hey, here, we're going to put you in ASA, we're going to put you in NASCAR. And that's just how it worked out. I mean, he kind of fulfilled his promises as long as I did mine. I went to college, I got my degree, and I did that. And to him, that was important because that was something he never did.
All right, guys, good job. See you later. See you, buddy. Okay. Hey, hold on, Larry. Take my
dry clean. White starch, no creases.
No creases. Right. Okay. See you guys. Rookies.
I'd have to do the same thing with our rookies. We just had bologna sandwiches.
I don't even think they had grills back in your
rookie. Did.
You know what?
We didn't.
It's fun to be, you know, one of the guys that's kind of carrying on that Mears name. You know, I mean, it's something that Dad and Rick have worked real hard, and they didn't work hard to promote their name, but they worked real hard, and it happened to make a name.
I think I heard my mom say, you know, that they probably gave up, you know, buying a new car or new furniture, or new carpet and things like that to make my racing keep going. And it's pretty cool to think of where I am now, Winston Cup racing, and at the biggest sport.
Man.
Can't believe they got me doing this.
Biffle, you're doing it wrong. You gotta go to the left. You're going to the right. You ought to know how to go left. Yeah, it works a lot better.
I raced that Tucson Winter Heat Series for 2 or 3 years, became friends with Benny Parsons, and Benny got me hooked up with Jack Roush, and that was it. They hired me sight unseen, no testing, no anything. They faxed me a contract.
Why don't you work on my toilet? Work on your toilet?
Yeah, if you don't mind.
Okay.
I got the stuff.
Oh, you're here.
I'll get it.
No problem. We're potty training a 2-year-old, so it might be a little messy.
Oh.
All right, the things they put the young guys through. But as a crew chief, you were part of some of that hazing, and it's necessary.
Exactly right. They've got to earn their stripes. I mean, whether you're a crew chief or a car member or whatever, driver, you've got to earn your stripes, don't you?
Oh, yeah, you can tell he's a rookie. He didn't have the roll of paper towels under his arm, and everybody knows it's wax on, wax off.
thanks for clarifying. This year's rookie age range from 24, Casey Mears, a couple of guys that are 38-year-old, Tony Raines, and also Jack Sprague. And of the five rookies that ran in the day, Daytona 500. All five finished the race. Jack Sprague fared the best in the group, finishing 14th. Last year's Rookie of the Year, Ryan Newman, finished 6th in points overall, and he has the distinction of holding an engineering degree from Purdue University, but learning from the school of hard knocks, surviving the spectacular crash from the Daytona 500 without a scratch. Today, back in the car to race for the first time since that, and Flying Ryan is standing by with our Genie Zelasko.
And Chris, Ryan said it himself, Disney World didn't have a ride as wild as that one. Kind of a bumpy start to the sophomore season, but I guess it's a new day today and the rest of the season unfolds.
Oh, for sure. Just really look forward to the race. It's a great racetrack here at Rockingham, and I'll tell Dodge is running pretty good. We got to come over here and test for 2 days, worked on race trim, so hopefully we're a game ahead of everybody else here.
Yeah, and we remember what happened to the last guy who finished dead last at the Daytona 500. He won the championship, so we're keeping the spirits up for the rest of the season. Dick?
Thanks, Jeannie. Goodyear has brought 3,000 tires to this event. And the teams are going to use virtually all of them. Every time you have a caution flag, the drivers are going to be in. They're going to fire four new ones at the car at $394 apiece. Why? This is the most abrasive of all the racetracks. Marble and stone sticks up through the asphalt, just tears at the tires. Object of the day, conserve those tires as best you can. The driver who will do the best job of conserving his tires is the driver most likely to win. To Maddie.
Dick, last fall, the majority of teams hit pit road 8 times. We could see the first of a possible 8 to 10 stops here on pit road on lap 45 when NASCAR throws a mandatory caution. But what that's going to mean is pit stops are going to be at a premium. 107 changes after the teams left Homestead till they reached Daytona. So how well will those changes make out here on pit road? We'll find out. But those changes could be the deciding factor between winning or losing. Pit stops here help Matt Kenseth win. Will it do it again? We'll find out. He's standing by with Steve Burns.
Well, Matt Kenseth qualified 18th, but don't be misled by a mediocre qualifying run. Everybody in the garage area this morning pointed to that yellow and black number 17 and said that's the car to beat. A year ago, Matt Kenseth qualified 25th and led 152 laps on the way to his first win of 2002. Chris Myers.
All right, I'm back with the guys in the Hollywood Hotel. And let's get a real quick reaction.
Yeah, I always tell Hammond, talking about tires, if my car handles real good, buddy, it'll take care of my tires.
Well, I agree with you there, but you've got to take care of the engine, too. Don't be busting my bow
springs.
That's
right. That's not a slinky. Okay, let's do our predictions. Three of the last six winners at Rockingham in the spring have gone on to win the points championship, so this could be more of something, a forerunner, than the Daytona 500. Who do you like this week, tonight?
Six. That's my number.
All right. Let's go up to Larry McReynolds in the booth. Larry?
I think this is where one of those new driver-crew chief combinations come together. I'm going to go with Bobby Labonte in the 18 car and that new crew chief, Michael Fatback McSwain.
All right.
Pretty impressive right there, Larry, but I'm going to go with the combination that was working really good at the end of last year, and that's Kurt Busch with Jimmy Finnick in a 97 car.
Okay, and just a thought on the pit crews and the pressure here. We saw a little bit of that, but it'll be different this time in terms of the tires, and it'll be four tires pretty much every stop.
Yeah, every time you come down pit road, you'd be getting four tires. So a good, consistent pit crew are the ones going to come out on top. What do you want to say now?
I want to tell you, it's a stopwatch. That's when you know to come get tires.
Right.
If you watch the stopwatch, when you start slowing down, you got to come get tires.
All right, and we want to tell you about that. You can be a NASCAR Grand Marshal for a day. Tune into the first hour of the Green Flag on Fox or FX. Look for the secret number on the animated car, then log on to NASCAR.com or FoxSports.com on Lycos. Enter the number for your chance to win. And the winner, start the race riding the pace car, even wave the checkered flag at the Winston Cup races in Rockingham in 2004. Be a NASCAR Grand Marshal for a day. The contest begins on Fox. For our guys here, thanks for watching the Napa Auto Parts pre-race show. And Jeff and I will be here throughout the race for observations. DW heads upstairs with Larry Mack and Mike Joy to call the Subway 400 from Rockingham, North Carolina. Stick around. The drivers are ready to go racing, and we are too on Fox.
Blue sky, smiling at me. Nothing but blue sky. I see blue days all up and all, nothing but blue skies from now on. Blue skies smiling at me, nothing but blue skies do I see.
NASCAR on Fox welcomes you to the North Carolina Speedway and the Subway 400 NASCAR Winston Cup race. Race two of the 2003 season, and for many of the teams freed of the restrictor plate racing of Daytona, the regular season starts here on this 1 mile speedway with different bankings at each end, D-shaped, where the drivers will chase their cars handling and the asphalt all day. Nice crowd in the grandstand as it's a beautiful spring day, clear skies, bright sun, but heavy, heavy winds across this racetrack. We're set to go racing, so let's go trackside for today's opening ceremonies. See how stiff these winds are as the flag is straight out in the breeze. The drivers have been introduced and they're in their cars and ready to go. Today, the storms that rained out the Busch race yesterday, and you'll see that on Monday on FX, that storm's blown through and it's now temperatures in the mid 50s. But look at those winds, 25 to 40 mile an hour gusts across this racetrack from the west. Sunny, but very windy. And the spotters up on the roof, they probably have the toughest job of all. And a new procedure this year. There are the spotters atop the press box, and they pick their positions up there based on how their driver qualified. So there are 43 of them in what is the windiest job of all up there atop the roof with that stiff breeze blowing. And the high winds have delayed us just a little bit here in our pre-race. Daytona 500 winner Michael Waltrip at the ready. Of course, none of these are the cars that raced in the Daytona 500, least of all Michael's. You can see his Daytona 500 winning car in Daytona, USA. Markingham, they've long called this track, for Mark Martin, who's had such great success here. Two Winston Cup victories and nine in the Busch Series, 11 in all. The winningest driver in the field today as far as this racetrack's concerned. So Waltrip comes here with the Winston Cup point lead. Otherwise, it's all up for grabs. Now let's go trackside.
Ladies and gentlemen, please rise and remove your hats as the Navy Color Guard from Naval Hospital Marine Corps Air Station, Cherry Point, North Carolina, presents today's colors, followed by Jim Ritter, minister from the Marston Baptist Church of Marston, North Carolina, as he delivers today's invocation.
May we pray. Our Father, we're grateful for a beautiful day that we can be out this afternoon. We pause to worship you, being our creator, our maker. May your blessings be upon the drivers and the crews as they exhibit their abilities. And as we end the race today, only one is going to win, but we're grateful that we're all part of your kingdom. May we enjoy this day and have fun. In your name we pray, amen.
Please remain standing as members of the ECU and Carolina Marching Bands perform today's national anthem.
Thank you.
Martini strike Eagles from the 333rd Fighter Squadron. And now for the most famous words in motorsports, please welcome today's Grand Marshal and a Subway's weight loss success story, Mr. Clay Henry.
Gentlemen, start your engine!
Sounds like Clay Henry was watching John Travolta last Sunday. Good job. 43 Winston Cup drivers at the ready. Only one-hour practice session. And now they tackle one of the roughest surfaces in NASCAR in a true test of tires and crew chiefs and drivers' ability to communicate and adjust throughout the day. 400 miles at Rockingham coming at you on Fox.
Hey, this is Jeff Green for NASCAR on Fox, and here we go. Boogity,
boogity,
boogity, boogity, boogity, boogity, boogity,
boogity, boogity, boogity, boys.
He was a famous trumpet man from out Chicago way, and he had a boogie style that no one else could play. He was the top man at his craft, but then his number came up, and he was gone with the draft. He's in the Army now, he's going reveille. He's the boogie woogie bugle boy of Company B. They made him blow a bugle for his Uncle Sam. It really brought him down because he could not jam. The captain seemed to understand, because the next day the captain went out and drafted a band. And now the company jumps when he plays reveille. He's the boogie woogie bugle boy of Company B.
The Subway 400 on Fox set to roll as the field warms up on a chilly, very windy, but sunny day in the sand hills of North Carolina, 400 miles. Hi, everybody. Mike Joy with Larry McReynolds and Darrell Waltrip. Now at Daytona, the best car with the best driver won. Darrell, what combination do you need to win on this place?
Well, what the crew chief's going to wait for when that driver starts whining, when he starts screaming
on that radio, and it ain't going to be long, is it, Larry?
On the pace lap.
As soon as those tires start going away, that driver's going to start screaming, I can't drive this thing. You, not me, you got to do something.
But the good thing about it, I can do something here. At Daytona for 11 days, if my car was good, it was good. If it was bad, I couldn't make anything, do anything to that car to make it faster. But here, I can make those adjustments, real critical to make that right adjustment on that last pit stop.
Now, what tools do you have at your disposal here to make that car handle differently?
Well, the thing about it, this racetrack's going to change all day long. And even a car that's leading the race, and it's hard to do sometime, that crew chief has to keep up with this racetrack. I'm going to make adjustments on that car, small adjustments, but I'm going to make adjustments even if I'm leading.
At the beginning of the day, they're holding up four like this. At the end of the day, they've held them up so long, they're holding them up like that.
That's four, tires,
four tires every
stop.
Time you come down pit road.
That's a good adjustment.
That's a good adjustment.
Tire.
That'll make that driver happy.
The Bud Poll Award. For the first time in his career, Dave Blaney is the Bud Poll winner. Budweiser, official beer of NASCAR and proud sponsor of the Bud Poll Award, given to the fastest qualifier at each Winston Cup race. Since 1979, Anheuser-Busch has awarded more than $8 million as title sponsor of NASCAR's Poll Award program. Congratulations to Dave and his new crew chief, Booty Barker, and that whole Jasper Engines and Transmissions team. He'll be on the pole as we take a look at the Napa starting grid, and Johnny Benson, who got his first career win right here in October, is right alongside a Ford and a Pontiac. Row two, Mark Martin, twice a Winston Cup winner here, and Sterling Marlin, runner-up in this race a year ago. Bill Elliott, three-time Rockingham winner. Ricky Craven, eight top tens here. Jamie McMurray, who won at Charlotte last October, and Rusty Wallace, a five-time winner here, making his 600th career start today. Dale Jarrett and Bobby Labonte, who both won here in 2000. That's your top ten. Have a look through the rest of the starting grid. And we'll have Darrell crank up the old wireless here.
Hey, JB, this is Darrell Waltrip up in the Fox TV booth. Buddy, you got a copy?
That's sir.
This is DW up in the tower up here, guys. Can I talk to JB there a second?
Go ahead, guys.
You know, I don't think we're getting through to JB. He doesn't seem to. I don't think they know who it is.
Let's see if we can check back under a caution a little later on.
That's not unusual because I know sometimes the radio and TV guys that come on my radio and I'd say to Hammond, Hammond, what's going on? Who are those people anyway?
The jet dryers are out, just blowing the track clean of mostly paper debris, wrappers and things like that, because we've had 40 mile an hour wind gusts here and it's really raising havoc.
And we haven't had any cars on the track, you know, since Friday. So the track's pretty dirty, a lot of sand and dirt blowing around. Really windy.
The reason you see two different groups out there, two pace cars, you have one pace car leading the top 20, the first 10 rows, and another pace car leading the rest of the field. This is for the first two pace laps because this is where these guys get their RPM reading for their pit road speed of 45 miles an hour, and it's easier to divide them into two groups. You can get a little better reading.
And they've added one pace lap just to get the track blown clear. The jet dryer's pulling in now.
Plus it's cool. And sometimes, you know, to get the temperatures up in the engines and everything, they'll add an extra lap or so also. So that's just kind of courtesy for the teams, get the fluids hot.
43 cars starting. There you see 393 laps, 400 miles. The pit window, we have two pit windows. We have the fuel pit window that we always talk about, but trust me, this is the one we'll be talking about most of the day, and that is the tire pit window. About 65 to 75 laps. If you try to go 90 laps on those tires, my driver is going to be whining.
Yeah, and early on particularly. I mean, as long as you can come in and get tires early on, that's what you'll do. Now, later in the day, when you get some rubber on the racetrack, tire wear will improve, and somebody will start stressing it out 85, 90 laps.
We were told that due to the lack of practice, and there was only one-hour practice session, that NASCAR will consider a competition yellow at approximately 45 laps if the yellow flag is not flown for an incident on the track prior to that, so teams can come in and check tire wear and their setup.
Yeah, and what you do, Mike, and Larry knows this, the crew chief, he just watches the stopwatch, and you're going to slow down, but when you get really, really slow, that's when he'll bring you in.
And you know, even though the air temperature is quite a bit cooler than we had the other day, because the sun's out, the track temperature is actually a little bit warmer than we had in that 1 hour practice the other day. There was no sun the other day, but the wind, it won't mess with the cars quite as bad, obviously, at a place like it would at Daytona, but that kind of wind, it will blow these race cars around.
You'll feel it down the front. It's a headwind down the front here, and it actually bucks the front of the car up. As it goes down the straightaway, particularly if you're by yourself.
And here especially, Darrell, if your car starts to go off a bit, you can get lapped here in a hurry. Doesn't take long.
Oh, yeah, there's no question about it. These guys mid-pack on back, you get somebody up front that's really running a fast pace, he'll put you down a lap in 30 laps.
And that's the reason I'd be a little bit nervous about that 45 laps. If I was a little bit questionable about my car, I'd say, can we not do it at 30 laps, 35 laps?
That's right in the I just got lapped window.
All right, Pontiac safety car is going to make that hard left turn this time. All right, race number two
tight,
in 2003. Here we go.
All right, we're coming down here, folks. On their feet, green flag. Boogity, boogity, boogity. Let's go racing, boys.
Mark Martin in that sixth car, he's putting pressure on Dave Blaney in that 77 early. He wants to get those 5 points for leading this first lap early. Blaney's on the high side, though, gets that momentum going.
And this is the first lap that's been run on this racetrack since Friday.
Dave Blaney leads the first lap by about 2 inches, I think.
Now, it's not just that Martin is so good at this racetrack, and he is. But this, to me, spells championship contender.
Well,
right from go.
This is totally uncharacteristic. Mark Martin is not a guy that goes up there and takes it to the, just takes it to you. He usually lets it come to him, but today he wants it bad.
Not yet. Blaney holds on, lap two.
And this is the first time Dave Blaney has ever led laps at Rockingham.
And he's pumped. I mean, he's got a new crew chief. He says it's a new kind of car, everything's different on this race car, and he is pumped, and he's poised to go fast all day long.
Single file, Ricky Craven coming up hard on the outside. Matt Yocum.
Well, Mike, in qualifying, Mark Martin remarked to his team he couldn't believe how well that six car turned on his qualifying attempt. He told his team this morning, if this car turns all day like it did in qualifying and doesn't get extremely tight, look for us to stomp him. That's confidence.
But Darrell, the 32 car, Craven right there, the Tide car, you about knew he was going to be the first one to start moving that race car up the racetrack. That's the great thing about Rockingham. You run all over the place. You run low at one end, high at the other.
Yeah, that's kind of what you do. You just, the car dictates where you're going to go. Of course, the drivers, some drivers like to get up there against that fence. They feel a little bit more comfortable up there.
And already we see cars climbing the hill, especially down in turns one and two, working the high end of the racetrack.
Now, folks, if you're at home there and you got a piece of paper, just take you a piece of paper and draw you a great big D. And that's what this racetrack is shaped like. When you come off of turn two onto the straight part of your D, there's not a lot of room. But when you come off of turn four around this big sweeping front straightaway, you can let the car do some different things. That's why you might run different lines on both ends of the racetrack.
And the field is now strung out the whole length of the back straightaway. Dave Blaney, Mark Martin, Bill Elliott, and there goes Craven up to the high side again. That's what makes this racetrack so fun to watch a Winston Cup race at. So many different choices of lines.
You can get such a run off of the corner when you're up high like that. Your car's free. You got a lot. You're back in the throttle a lot earlier, and you can really get a run down the straightaway when you get up high like that.
What's happened to Johnny Benson dropping from second to sixth? Got hung on the outside for just a bit. Now he and Sterling Marlin battle for sixth spot.
Well, there's battling going on everywhere right now.
And you know, Darrell, if the car likes the high line, I like it as a crew chief because that's a little easier on the tires up there. You're not working them as hard as you would if you were at the bottom of the racetrack.
Oh, what we said, when you get down in that hole down on the bottom right there and you're working that wheel and grinding that right front tire, it won't take you very long.
Steve Burns on Johnny Benson.
And, Mike, there may be nothing wrong with Johnny Benson. Just seconds before the green flag, Johnny told his crew, guys, I'm going to be a little bit slow at the start, but hang with me. Once we get going, this thing's going to be bad fast.
Patience. Meanwhile, Craven is closing on the leaders. There's the gap to that bright orange Pontiac of Ricky Craven, and it is narrowing every lap.
And so many new things. I know they sat on the pole here a year ago. They've always ran well here. This is actually the same chassis. We got Mark all over Blaney here for the lead coming off turn four, and he's going to lead lap nine.
I think that Blaney may have said, okay, Mark, you're hounding me. I'm going to let you go. That's good driving.
Well, Mark got right up against Blaney's left rear corner. Kind of edged him out of the way.
And it broke his momentum. Craven's going to take the second spot away down the backstretch. But again, this is the same chassis they ran here. But remember, they've made the swap from the Ford to the Pontiacs. And that's a big engine change as well.
I'm going to show you what happened going down the back here just a moment ago. We're talking about good, tight, close racing all in the field. Watch these guys. They come up turn two here. The teammates ran into each other. Got some damage on the back of the 38 car there. I think Dale Jr. must get into the back of him. Coming up off the corner. Whoa, checked up. That was almost a big one.
There with these guys, they have 10 laps on their tires. Already these things are starting to slide around.
Yeah, Dale Jr.'s got damage. He hit the back of the 38 car and it damaged the left front. He's got it into the tire.
Got a small left front fender rub there, Jr. Just in the corners.
Now that may or may not be a problem. You can wear that down, push that, the tire will push that fender out of the way, as long as it's not affecting the way it's driving. If it's hanging up in the fender, he's not going to like that.
Meanwhile, Bill Elliott has moved to third, Rusty Wallace to fourth, Blaney fades to fifth.
And this is so gut-wrenching for a crew chief, Darrell.
Oh, still inside.
That's Ty Norris's spotter talking to him right there because you know you need to bring that thing to pit road to get that fender off that tire. But if you do it here, as long as this pit road is under green, you're going to go a minimum of two laps down.
Just have to leave it up to the driver. I mean, I always hated that when they said, did you make the call? I hated to have to do that, but you're out there in it, so you know what you got to do.
13 laps complete in the Subway 400 on Fox. A new leader. You see Ricky Craven come off turn four and set up Mark Martin for the lead going down into turn one.
And then Mark immediately was running around the bottom. As you can see, as soon as Craven got by him, Mark said, hey, how'd you do that? So he starts running the high line.
Yeah, I mean, I'm watching the top nine cars, and while ago, a couple laps ago, the only car that was running the low line in three and four was Sterling Marlin in the 40 car. Now he's moved up there, too, so the top 10 are all running the high line, especially in three and four.
My driver buddies all have that monkey see, monkey do mentality.
And the lap times have dropped off a full 1.2 seconds from the start of the race in only 20 laps. Rusty Wallace chasing Bill Elliott. This is for third.
Rusty was one of the ones on Friday that elected to spend a lot of that practice time, what little there was, working on race setup, and it looks like it's paying off for him. But I'm going to tell you, Rusty has always ran well at this place.
Well, what I think we're seeing, Larry, is a number of these cars that had teammates come down here and test have put in their teammates' testing setup, is what some of them told me.
You see Rusty going to third, passing Bill Elliott in the 9 car. And, yeah, Ricky Craven, he's a single car team, but he came down here and tested.
A lot of veterans up toward the front. Some of the rookies having trouble. Watch the 41 top of your screen. Casey mirrors the red car.
Bam. It's coming up off turn 2. You just run out of racetrack. The car's in a four-wheel slide.
It's like I said, you just run out of room off the 2 over there. That's the straight part of the D, and it's pretty tight up off that corner.
Jamie McMurray in the 42 also.
Casey mirrors teammate.
Now, Mark Martin is letting him go. Not indicative of Martin having a problem.
Nope.
Big picture racing, Darrell.
That's Mark Martin's style. You come up and pressure him a few laps, he's not going to tolerate that. He'll let you go by.
And, Darrell, what I see, we talked about this a minute ago, it looks like a lot of them are electing to run a little bit low into turn 1 because the transition into turn 1 is not as abrupt as it is into 3 and 4.
You see the fender on the 25 bend in on Joe Nemechek, likely from contact with Jamie McMurray that we saw a minute ago.
I've been watching some of the cars back in the pack, and they've been beating a fire out of each other, leaning on each other, bumping into each other. A lot of racing going on.
Now at Daytona, that might cost him a second a lap, but here?
Probably won't hurt him at all as long as it don't start rubbing that tire like we saw with Dale Earnhardt Jr.
And Jr.'s still out there. He has not pitted, and that tire rub has pretty well gone away. Alongside him is Johnny Benson, who started outside pole. Steve?
Mike, right before the race, as I reported, Johnny Benson said, I'm going to be conservative. But now he just told crew chief James Hintz that the car has a handling problem. It's loose going into one, and it's tight in the center on both ends of the racetrack. The car does not want to pivot. Back upstairs.
For the lead, Rusty Wallace puts the number 2 Dodge out in front.
Boy, that's got to put a smile on his face because, you know, he's always run well here. I think he's got 5 wins here. He likes this place. Hadn't run well here the last couple of times we've been, but today looks like he's got her dialed in.
It's the 16th time that Wallace has led a Winston Cup race at Rockingham. First time he's led those since October of 2000.
And it's his 600th career Winston Cup start today.
They've had 75 Winston Cup races at this racetrack. First one was in 1965. You know who won it?
Curtis Turner.
Curtis Turner. You know who was on pole?
No.
I didn't either till. I thought you might know. No, Richard Petty actually was on the pole.
Dude, watching Elliott Sadler in the 38 car there. He started in 11th, and he's up to 8. Dick Bergeron, what do you know about Elliott Sadler?
Well, I know the crew is very concerned about the grill in that car. He early on had contact with his teammate and has pretty well torn that grill up. When he comes in for a pit stop, the crew's going to go to work and try to fix it.
Sadler right behind Sterling Marlin, right behind Bobby Labonte, who's been making quite a run at Dave Blaney's 5th place spot there. Last lap, Labonte went low in that green Chevrolet, but to no avail. They stay single file.
I'm going to tell you, a guy that started deep in the field. In fact, he started 33rd. Our current Winston Cup champion, Tony Stewart. I've been watching him. He's hugging that white line, at least for the most of these laps. And he's already moved up to 19th. So he's almost chopped this field in half in 30 laps.
When you have a track that's hard on tires and abrasive and wears them like this track does, the key guy on your race team is the shock guy. And Tony and Bobby Labonte have a shock guy they call Dr. Who. Ronnie Crux, and he is a master at figuring out shocks for these kind of racetracks.
He's been getting about a car lap, and just like you saw right there in 3 and 4, and you'll see it here in 1 and 2, he's about the only car that's hugging that white line at both ends of the racetrack, and that's a sign of a good handling car, Jeff Hammond, after 30 laps.
Another guy started back here in the back, was fast in practice, was Ryan Newman. He started back like 22nd. He's already worked his way up right now where he's knocking on the top 10 and kind of been watching his track times, Larry. He's probably got about the second or third fastest car right now on the racetrack.
And he had a fast race car Friday. He just overdrove his race car when he went to qualify it.
And Flying Ryan has also been right around the white line you see at the bottom of the racetrack since we started. Rusty Wallace has opened up 8/10 of a second on Ricky Craven. Bill Elliott's third, Mark Martin's fourth, and Bobby Labonte is fifth. Every one of the four makes in Winston Cup Racing with a car in the top five. Trouble in turn four. The car has bounced off the wall.
That was just a controlled slide. He gathered it back up. Tony Raines in the 74 car. Yeah.
And we're going to stay green. So we'll get you to break and be right back with the Subway 400 on Fox. The Subway 400 on Fox is brought to you by Subway. Fresh-made sandwiches on fresh-baked bread. Subway, eat fresh. By Ford. If you haven't looked at Ford lately, look again. By Valvoline's Max Life. Take better care of your higher-mileage vehicle with Valvoline's Max Life. And by Napa Auto Parts. 40 laps complete at the North Carolina Speedway. Rusty Wallace in the lead. He's the fourth driver to lead today. And let's show you what happened to Tony Raines just as we were going to commercial.
Well, now, sometimes the wall can be your best friend. And in this case, it was. He just about was to spin that thing out. He got the right rear up against the wall, straighten him up, and on he went.
A cut right rear tire for Raines. Derek Cope has taken his car to the garage. Otherwise, we continue caution free. Ricky Craven in second in a Pontiac behind Wallace's Dodge. Bill Elliott's Dodge. Be the third place car. He's about another 1.3 seconds back.
And where are those mighty Chevrolets from Daytona?
Well, Elliott Sadler's Ford has fought its way up to fourth place. And Mark Martin's Ford, after leading a few laps to get some bonus points. Mark right there in fifth. Sterling Marlin in sixth in a Dodge. And the first of those Chevys, Darrell, will be Bobby Labonte in seventh. Then our pole sitter, Dave Blaney, his Ford in eighth place. And we pick up some audio between Dave and his spotter and crew.
Atta boy, Dave. It's a long race. You're doing good. Good job. It's your mark. Your mark.
Pretty free off. Just kind of babying it here.
That's what I like to hear, Larry. And Jeff, you're down there. I know you're listening. If you got to talk to that driver, tell him he's doing a good job.
Yeah, you're exactly right there, Darrell, because, you know, you and I have been here before, and that sometimes that conversation, just letting you know that I'm with you, what you're doing is right, how your lap times are in comparison to the leader, or if you are the leader, how crucial all that kind of works out as far as tire management. Because if you can back off a little bit and save your tires by slowing down a little bit, that's not a bad thing. If you need to kind of stay after it because the leader's gaining on you, you might do something different. Number eight car, Darrell, you like a flat left front tire.
Jeff, I think finally that fender rubbed that tire, but the caution is out, so what a break for him, because this is the competition caution right here.
Boy, that was a big break.
What a break.
It is lap 45, and NASCAR told the drivers in their mandatory drivers meeting this morning.
Flat tire, Jack, somebody. Got to get the car up first.
That if there was not a caution prior to lap 45, NASCAR would put one out so the drivers could evaluate tire wear.
And you heard him telling the crew, we have to have the flat tire jack, because what he's talking about, the frame rail will be so low because that tire's flat, they have a jack that's a little shorter to get the left side up.
And what's amazing about this place is as much bumping and banging and all different groups people run, we never have many cautions here.
And the reason he hadn't come to pit road yet, he's trying to get caught up with the field because the pace car just took the leader over there, so they'll be able to pit this time.
Sure, you got to be careful not to tear the whole nose off the thing.
But you're right, Larry. If he pitted this time, the pace car was so close to him, he would have lost a lap before they could get that tire
changed.
Very
borderline. Yeah, this pit road is very long. They come in right here off of turn four, 45 miles an hour, goes all the way around and don't come off of pit road to turn two.
They used to pit on both the front and back straightaways here, and that was adjusted to one long pit road to eliminate any advantage the front stretch teams might have had.
This was a big break for Jeff Green in the 30 car because he was just a little bit from going lap. Jeannie.
Well, and a big break, of course, for the rookie Jamie McMurray, who lost a lot of track time because of the weather. He's been complaining the car's a little tight in and loose off. Tire pressure adjustments for them, of course, because where we're at.
Sterling Marlin getting four tires, air out of the right front. One round of wedge in for Sterling Marlin. Matt.
Work already going on the left side of Mark Martin's car. Four tire change. Already made a wedge adjustment and air pressure. He was too loose, Dick.
Rusty Wallace is already out of here. They just flipped the car absolutely alone other than four tires. Ricky Craven's car, they loosened him up a little bit. Rusty will inherit the lead.
We had trouble on pit road there. Jeff Gordon got shoved into the pit. You know, I saw where he picked his pit. It's way down here toward turn four. I said, why would he do that? It's because that was what I was afraid of. It, you'd get shoved into the fence when you're exiting the pits.
There you see him trying to get the left side up to change that flat left front. Matt Yoakum.
And they've already got that left front off. They're going to beat away some of that bodywork. Also work on some of the brake ducking underneath. Kevin Pinnell, the Jackman.
Now here's what happened to Jeff Gordon along the pit lane. He gets kind of squeeze played right there. As Biffle comes out of his pit, Johnny Benson is there, and Gordon has to hit the brake.
It's a very narrow pit road.
2 years ago, a caution helped Steve Park. He was 5 seconds from going a lap down. The caution, he got back on the lead lap and won here. Welcome back to the Subway 400 on Fox. Rusty Wallace, the leader after pit stops at 50 laps. We showed you the replay of Jeff Gordon having a real close call on pit road and picked up some radio chatter about it.
Got in the wall a little bit. I think I barely touched it, though. It should be fine.
10-4. Well, Jeff, were you hearing static and stuff on Ron's radio? Should we have him try another radio there?
He's definitely breaking up.
Well, that's a problem. Ron is Ron Thiel, Jeff's spotter.
And when you talk about a pit road like this, we talked about it last week at Daytona, because that driver's in there, maybe not Jeff Gordon, but Greg Biffle, who pulled out on him, they're in there and they can't see. They don't have a lot of peripheral vision, so it's on the spotter's shoulders and the crew chief's shoulders to help these cars in their pit box and leave it.
Now, Dale Earnhardt Jr. has made 4 pit stops after cutting down that front tire. But he is still on the lead lap. Make that 5 pit stops as you ride with him down pit road at the 45-mile-an-hour speed limit. He's the only car in the pit lane, and Matt's waiting on him.
And this is his 5th stop, Mike. And the problem for Dale Earnhardt Jr. on his first stop, they had to pull all the rubber, which is wrapped around the spindle. Also, the damage is they're going to take that left front off again. It has supposedly broken the fender braces up underneath, so they're going to try to work on that as the field is coming around out of turn 4. They are keeping Junior abreast of where the field is so he will not lose a lap. Tony Urie Jr., the car chief, on the radio. He has gone back up, and you can see the damage to that left front fender.
Well, Matt, the real problem is this pit road is so long and maintaining 45 miles an hour. By the time Dale Earnhardt Jr. gets to his pit box from being at the tail end of the field is in turn 4, so they don't have very long to work on it each time.
Let's go down to the Hollywood Hotel. Chris Myers has our race break brought to you by Visa.
And with Jeff Hammond, we talked about the 6 rookies running in today's race, but it is the veterans, Rusty Wallace, Bill Elliott, and Mark Martin of the top 3. In fact, 130 wins combined, and that tells you experience on this track?
Got to have that experience, Chris. I mean, this is what this racetrack's all about. Tire management, being smooth on and off the throttle, not overly using your tires, and that's where these guys are at the top of the field right now. They know how to work that process out.
What do you lose, about 10 miles per hour from the long run?
About 2 seconds. You lose about 2 seconds a lap from start to the finish of a run.
And Rusty Wallace, it's pointed out he's won here 5 times. He, of course, won in a Pontiac and in a Ford at Rockingham. This time he's in a Dodge and is your current leader. Just a quick thought on what Dale Earnhardt Jr. is experiencing. Looked like he caught a break with the mandatory caution, but he's in trouble.
Oh, he really did. He caught a really lucky break, because otherwise, if it went for NASCAR's mandatory caution flag, he would be already a lap down, and probably more than that. So he got an opportunity to come and work on his car. And I talked to his crew chief, Tony Jr., earlier this morning. They need a good run here if they want to get back to the point championship already. They're looking at points.
Dave Blaney, the pole sitter, currently running 7th. That is our Visa race break from the Hollywood Hotel. Let's go back upstairs.
40 cars on the lead lap. The last of those are Earnhardt Jr. and Joe Nemechek, who's made 3 pit stops under this caution. 2 drivers are laps down, and they're both rookies. Larry Foyt, 2 laps back, and one lap back, and Tony Raines, who is 2 laps back. The only car in the garage is Derek Cope.
The reason Joe Nemechek has made so many pit stops, remember, we saw that damage on his left front fender. They've been trying to repair that.
Robbie Gordon at work. 53 laps down, 340 to go.
Pulled it back into second gear there.
And getting set for the restart.
Real tight up here. Green flag.
Of course, those 2 cars that are lapped down, Larry Foyt and Tony Raines, up there trying to get their lap back, but I don't think it's going to happen. Mike. I know it's early in the race, but what do you think?
Let's crank it up. Nearly trouble with a capital T back in that second pack as Rusty Wallace, Bill Elliott, and Mark Martin scoot away from the field.
I tell you, the engines sound a lot different here than they did at Daytona, don't they? At 800 horsepower.
And they're turning about 2,000 more RPMs than that 9,000 here, especially on those fresh tires. But I'm going to tell you, a group that was awesome at Daytona last week, aside from Dale Earnhardt Incorporated, Richard Childress Racing. But I'm telling you, they have went from the penthouse to the outhouse because Robbie Gordon is the highest Childress car right now in 25th. Harvick, Kevin Harvick, in the 29 is 27th. His other teammate, Jeff Green, is 28th. Harvick came down here and tested. And if you picked a racetrack where Jeff Green had two awesome races last year, it was right here at Rockingham.
Yeah, and he almost went a lap down there before that mandatory caution. So definitely struggling. But that's not always indicative of how it's going to end up, because this track goes through some changes. As rubber gets put down on the racetrack, cars that are not very good could come to the front before the day's over.
Robbie Gordon battling John Andretti, who makes his 300th career start today.
I tell you, a guy that was running there in the top five, six, or seven, we had talked about him. He had to come back to pit road, and he's all the way back in about the 39th position. Elliott Sadler in that 38 car. Remember, you heard Dick Bergeron talk about the grill. They had to come in a couple of times and repair that screen wire. And you would think, well, why don't you just take the screen wire off? Well, here we talk about the tires wearing out. If you took that screen wire off, Dick Bergeron, the rubber would clog the radiator up.
Well, they still got some grill work in there on that number 38 car, but the problem is that they've had trouble keeping the temperature down there, and that's why they came in a second time to do some more work.
Yeah, it's like, Dick, it's like a barbecue grill. Going to cook the engine if they don't do something.
And just like at Daytona, Darrell, I think a lot of these teams are still struggling with these all these new noses to find out just how you can run the tape to block the front end up.
Well, it's a cool day, and so everybody's got maximum tape on right now.
Dick Bergeron.
Well, Rusty Wallace has got a very well-balanced race car right now, reflected in the tire wear. That's good for two reasons. One, a well-balanced car is fast, and two, here at Rockingham, it'll let those tires last a long, long time.
I mean, that's the thing, Darrell, and you know it from running so many races here. You can go out there and run much faster than you can, or you want to run faster than you can those first 10 laps, but if you do, it's going to go away much quicker.
Oh, yeah, and the big thing, and I don't want to harp on it too much, but this track will change at about 200 laps. The track will go through a transition, and I tell you, I've seen cars here that were so loose and guys couldn't drive them. They adjust them up and get them good for the end of the day, and they're up there in the hunt at the end of the race.
Fastest car on the racetrack, the bright orange Pontiac of Ricky Craven and the blue and white Dodge of Ryan Newman. They are slicing fast through this field.
I mean, you heard Jeff Hammond talk about Ryan Newman. He's all the way up to seventh, so he definitely has one of the quicker cars.
And Craven just continues to work that outside, while Newman has been working the bottom of the racetrack. But whatever it is, it's working for both of them.
There's Sterling Marlin up there. He's not in too bad a shape either, Larry. I've been watching him, and his car looks like it's handling really, really well. And Sterling's the kind of guy that kind of paces himself, thinks about the big picture.
Brought a brand new race car here, untested. Never been to the racetrack till they unloaded it on Thursday.
Last car on the lead lap after those five pit stops, Dale Earnhardt Jr. Matt can update us.
And the problems continue for Jr., Mike. He's reporting in his team he still has a vibration in the suspension area. Now he thinks it may be something wrong with the left front rotor.
you see the telemetry right there. See the interval back up to the leader, Rusty Wallace, 15 seconds. That's over a half a lap back.
When you wrapped it, when that tire came apart and it started wrapping around all up in there, no telling what kind of damage it's done.
New second place car, Ricky Craven.
Likes that high line. He rode it there earlier in the race and it worked for him.
Now following Ryan Newman up through the pack is Kurt Busch. He's the second Ford in the race behind teammate Mark Martin, who's third. And Busch now in eighth place. Pretty much following along in Newman's tracks, but working a different line on the racetrack there. Busch goes high as Newman stays low.
Here's Sierra leader Rusty Wallace in the two car, a little over 2 seconds ahead of Ricky Craven, but Craven's running a little bit quicker than Rusty. But back to Kurt Busch, started back in 27th. Those guys had a great run here in the fall. I talked to Jimmy Finney, his crew chief, this morning. He said it's a completely different setup, though. Our setup from the fall, when we made some race runs the other day, was way too tight. The car would not turn it off.
He told me they put Mark's setup in, that they threw the, what Mark had run here. It was pretty successful through the years, so they just put his setup in there. I think that's pretty smart.
Not a bad setup.
No.
69 laps complete here at the Rock. Rusty Wallace leads the Subway 400 on Fox. The Subway 400 on Fox is brought to you by Dodge. You can take life as it comes, or you can grab life by the horns. Dodge. Dodge leads the Subway 400. Rusty Wallace with a 2.4 second lead on Ricky Craven's Pontiac and Mark Martin's Ford. Here's a look from our Budweiser aerial coverage.
That 40 car is the car I'm keeping an eye on, Larry. He just seems to be clicking them off. I think he's actually a little bit quicker than Rusty is right now.
He's about a tenth quicker than Rusty that last lap.
I talked to those guys over there this morning, and they were really happy with their car. They thought they would have a good day, and they were right.
Let's update you. Our front row runners, Dave Blaney, who started on pole, is 10th. And here's Johnny Benson, the outside pole sitter and October winner, running in 17th. Steve?
And Mike, Johnny Benson reported that his car would not pivot. It would not turn in the center of the corners. We'll use Jeff Hammond's Ford cutaway car to explain what they did on that last stop. Now, this is the left front spring. On the right front spring, they took this spring rubber out, and that should hopefully change the handling characteristics and help that number 10 car turn.
And Steve, the odd thing about the rubber in the right front spring is you cannot start a race with a rubber in the right in either front spring. But what NASCAR let these guys do because of lack of practice time is if they wanted to put a half a rubber in either front spring, which would up the rate about 100, 150 pounds, they could start the race. But it didn't take those guys long to get that one out of that right front, soften that spring rate.
Meanwhile, Dale Earnhardt Jr. has diagnosed the problem he's having with his Chevrolet.
I know what it is. It's the brake rotor or something that tore up on the car. I'm losing the brake. I'm about out of brakes, Junior. Damn it, you got a rotor out here or anything? Well, let's get a rotor out here because you're going to change the rotor probably.
And that'll be time consuming.
Oh, yeah.
And I'd say there's a good chance, Jeff, that probably when that tire went down, that it could have maybe put a little flat spot on the rotor or maybe even put a crack in that rotor.
Yeah, Larry, I think you're right on that. He probably got maybe some rubber on it. Thing was real hot, and all of a sudden it's messed it up really bad. So it's right now, as you're sitting there looking, there's a rotor right there on the cutaway part of our race car. And as you can see right there with the caliper, if you get that rubber caught up in there, it could real easily get on the brake pad and, again, give the driver a sensation of it being bent or warped. And it doesn't take a whole lot to mess a rotor up.
And if you notice those fins right there, what that is, that's cooling fins. That's to help cool the rotor. Matt Yoakum.
Well, Larry, if they have to change that, as you mentioned, it's going to be very time-consuming. Second straight week, Junior's had some kind of mechanical issue. Remember back to last week, they had an alternator problem. During the red flag, Jeff Clark, the engine tuner, they'd actually practiced preparing to change the alternator. They had it down to 35 seconds. Unfortunately, it's going to take them a lot longer. They've got to work on that rotor today.
Yeah, because, I mean, you just the heat just in changing that thing is going to be immense. And, you know, again, they had a regulator go out in their alternator. I asked Jeff Clark, how much does a regulator cost? He said, $1.4 million.
Yeah, that but, you did. Know, it, what's wrong with the Junior's car was because he ran into somebody. He got the fender into the tire, cut the tire down, so it's not like they did something wrong with the car itself, kind of created that on their own.
Second place taken by Sterling Marlin. Ricky Craven, Mark Martin battling there. Right there for second place. That's about 3 seconds behind race leader Rusty Wallace. Now the Singular Wireless virtual crew chief question. Vote now from your Singular Wireless phone by sending text message FOX to phone number 191 or visit foxsports.com to vote online.
Sterling Marlin has quietly moved into second place and is nibbling away at our leader.
This is Michael Waltrip you're looking at in the 15 car. He's back in 29th position. He's trying the bottom of the racetrack right here.
Car hadn't looked all that sporty. He's been all over the place trying to find someplace where the car would be comfortable and just hadn't found it.
Steve Burns.
Well, Darrell, you talked about how good Sterling Marlin is. It's hard to believe, but he's never won at Rockingham. Just after the last caution, Tony Glover, the team manager, said you're the fastest car on the racetrack. And the longer this race goes, the long green flag runs, that 40 car is the fastest.
And he's backing that up, just what we're seeing, Steve, on the stopwatch and watching the timing monitor.
And our pole sitter, Dave Blaney, has given up a spot to last year's winner of this race, Matt Kenseth. In the wall, Todd Bodine.
Caution
turn two.
Out. Caution is out.
One of the things that you do here, and Larry will tell you, to make the car turn, you'll start letting that air pressure down in that right front tire. The more air you let out of it, the better the car will turn, but it also can damage the tire.
Boy, that was a break for Kevin Harvick, because Kevin Harvick in that 29 car, he was about to go a lap down.
Second caution of the day. The first one was the competition caution of lap 45 due to the lack of practice. And this is the second yellow for Todd Bodine, who has hit the wall coming out of turn two and now makes it all the way around onto pit road with a lot of damage to the right front.
Trust me, we ran 32 laps. Pit road will be very busy. Everybody will be in for four tires and adjustments.
That's right. Crew chiefs are hauling. Close it up. These guys back here, close it up and pit next time by.
Bodine with a flat tire, looks like a busted upper A-frame, and who knows what else. Lots of damage to the right front.
And you talked about the troubles for Jeff Gordon earlier on pit road. He's going to have to go around Todd Bodine to get in his pit, so his pit road dilemma continues.
Yeah, NASCAR official just warned the 54 crowd that there are going to be other cars coming down pit road. Probably wishes he could get out of there before they do.
And the only car to be left on the racetrack right now will be the pace car.
Steve Burns.
Mike, they'll go down half a round on that track bar for Sterling Marlin when he hits the pits. He's got a nice shot in here. Open pit stall in front of him. Mike Atwell and Nate Kennan on the tires. Tim Shore and Trent Davis, the tire carrier. Four tires for Sterling Marlin. Dejeni Zelasco.
And Jeff Gordon has been complaining this car is pushing real bad going in. We needed an adjustment going down on the tire pressure in the right rear and four tires and fuel. Matt?
Mark Martin already in the car has gone a little bit to the loose side, but Mark doesn't want to adjust too much. He's afraid he's going to over-adjust it, Dick.
Rusty Wallace came in with the lead. They're going to fire four tires at it. No changes. That car is virtually perfect. Right in front of him, Ricky. Oh, and the number six, Mark Martin, has beaten Wallace off pit road. Craven has asked for more bite, and he's going to take off in the middle of the pack.
Bobby Labonte in 18 car. He's going to jump from sixth to third, so that crew getting the job done as well.
You don't often see Rusty's crew beat pit road.
You know, I think at Wilbur, Billy Wilmer, his crew chief's actually changing right front tire today, or front tires today, because they're looking for somebody to do that job.
Todd Bodine has gone to the garage, and repairs continue on Junior's car.
See, Dale Earnhardt Jr. in 8 car, trust me, if they're thinking about changing that brake rotor, you're still going to lose a lot of laps, but now would be the time to do it, not while we're green flag racing.
Well, I'm sure right now they're just trying to analyze the problem, looking down in there, seeing if they can see anything, see what they need to do. There goes Mark.
He beat Rusty by a lot.
Oh, yeah.
A clear winner on the race off pit road. 89 laps complete at one of the toughest tracks to tame in NASCAR. We're racing at the Rock. It's the Subway 400 on Fox. Getting set for the restart. Todd Bodine has joined Derek Cope in the garage. 41 cars will take the restart.
Green, green.
39 of them on the lead lap. Led by Mark Martin, Rusty Wallace, Bobby Labonte, Kurt Busch, and Sterling Marlin.
Sort of a familiar cast of characters at the front here at the Rock.
And if you go behind Sterling Marlin, another familiar cast of character would be Tony Stewart in sixth.
for the lead. Rusty around the outside.
And Bobby Labonte in 18, he's going to try to follow Rusty around the outside of Mark Martin.
Sweet. Looking good.
Sweet, baby, sweet. Oh, trouble down there. Whoa.
Blaney got roughed up there as they were three wide in the middle of the corner.
They hit him sideways.
It's a battle for 16th right here. Dale Jarrett, the UPS car. Mike Skinner in the four car right behind Dave Blaney.
And Kurt Busch moves around his Roush Racing teammate. Up to third place. Haven't seen Jeff Burton yet today. He is in 18th.
And I tell you, that's quite a move, Mike, considering he started 38. And remember, in qualifying the other day, leaving pit road when he looked like he went to third gear, spun out and hit the wall. Paul Andrews and that group repaired that car.
43 cars back in there. I don't know if he's got damage on the fenders or what, but he's got some smoke trailing him. As he goes down in a corner, tells me it must be tires.
It's John Andretti.
See that left front? Boy, it shoots him right up the hill, too.
And you know, again, Darrell, you build up so much air pressure on a long run here. As they expand, start them so low, sometimes we'll see that out of a lot of cars at the beginning of a run, the air pressure builds up.
Watching from Robbie Gordon, there's a little of that smoke from John Andretti.
Yeah, now, and you guys always, you crew chiefs always saying, just be patient, it'll come to you. Well, while it's coming to me, they're going off and leaving me, buddy.
Yeah, I mean, you'd love to let them, the further down you let them, the better it is for a long run, but sometimes you let them down so far, you give up too much in the beginning of a run.
Exactly.
Up front now, Rusty Wallace and Bobby Labonte has moved his Chevrolet into second. Dick Bergman.
And sometimes you can go faster by going easier. Bobby Labonte has changed his driving style so that he is going into the corners more easily than he was at the beginning of this race. He started in 10th. He's already up to second. Going easy seems to be working well for him.
And Dick, he knows how to get around this place. In the last eight races, he has finished third or better in five of those races.
And when you overdrive this racetrack, the car just washes out. You drive it down in the corner, you got to get on the brakes a little bit, and it'll just slide. It'll just slide up the hill. It wears out the tires much quicker that way. You just back off early and let the car roll down into the corners, we say, and pick that throttle up early, right about where he is right there. I mean, you'll make a lot better time.
14th place, you'll find Jeff Gordon. He's been battling Jamie McMurray and Mike Skinner.
There you see on the Fox tracks right there, his interval up to our leader, Rusty Wallace, about 6 seconds. That's about a quarter of a lap down. He looks like he's kind of maintaining right now, maybe losing just a little bit.
Jeannie?
Get interesting, guys. Jeff Gordon just called into crew chief Robbie Loomis to let him know just how much the track has changed. Remember, the rain canceled the Busch race on Saturday, and now that the cars have been out on the track, there is finally some rubber out there on the track to change some of the handling conditions. Gordon also quick to point out, hey, guess what? Without Bodine out here, it's easier for me to get into my pits. Matt?
Junior came back in one more time, Jeannie, before he went back to green. He said the car plows when he goes in the corner. In fact, he said it feels like the left rear tire is coming up off the ground. So what they did, they made an adjustment to that left rear shock, 8 sweeps out. He says the car is just very, very ill. Steve?
Well, Matt, Kevin Harvick is struggling today on that last stop. They pulled spring rubbers out of the left front and the right rear. The car is terrible loose. Crew Chief Gil Martin said when they tested here that they just weren't sure if they got a handle on it, and they don't today.
And that's one of the reasons they tested here. They just never felt like they've had a handle on this racetrack with Kevin Harvick.
And my experience has been when you got to start adjusting the shocks in the race, you're in big trouble.
It's going to be a long day.
Yes.
Pick up the 10th place battle, Bill Elliott, Ward Burton, Jimmy Johnson.
Well, there's Jamie McMurray right there behind them. They're racing pretty dadgum hard.
Jimmy Johnson started 37th. He's gained 25 positions.
Those guys were a little nervous this morning. Talked to Chad Knaus, his crew chief, because they were one of the teams on Friday elected to stay in qualifying trim. You see Jamie McMurray in the 42 car. I tell you what, this is his second Winston Cup start here. He's doing a really good job.
Man, I got to tell you, though, Larry, to have a teammate like he does and everything, that's kind of makes it a huge difference. Getting the car set up right, And having those notes to look at from past experience here, it makes just a huge difference.
Here goes McMurray looking to the inside of Johnson, and there wasn't room when they got to the corner, and now there is on the bottom.
I love this racetrack. Yeah, just watching these guys run.
And don't forget, Jamie McMurray won the Busch race here last fall. So he knows how to get around here, and he's doing a good job today.
Do you have any Lincoln Park in your CD changer, Darrell?
Not lately.
Have any in your Lincoln or where your Lincoln's parked?
I ain't drove a late. I ain't driven a Lincoln lately. Uh-oh, whoa, who is that?
I don't know, but he's
Kenny
in trouble.
Wallace, 23 car.
Caution. That'll be caution
out
for the third time today at lap 107.
That's Kenny Wallace back there, I think. Yeah.
Yes.
Get the back inside wall, guys.
Off turn two. Most, down the back straightaway.
Most everything happens off turn two here. It's just so hard to get off of that turn. Boy, he has put that thing right to the, put the nose right in the wall.
That's the world's strongest fender burner right there.
He needs Big Fun or Big Show or whatever his name
right
is to pull those out.
A bit. He got the whole front end. Might need a radiator.
Step four, take it to the garage if it's that bad.
Oh no, just tell me.
Come to Pier Road, come to Pier Road.
Yeah, it doesn't look that bad.
Yeah, Mike, it looks that bad.
Let's ride with Kenny Wallace through turn two.
That thing just jumped loose. Maybe we'll see right here.
Yeah, let's see who's behind him here. Whoops.
One whack jack.
Whoops.
Check sprayed.
Yeah.
Zero car.
Imagine that.
Now, this puts the tire deal in perspective. 15 laps, everybody's to pit road. Four more tires and adjustments, Steve Burns.
And Sterling Marlin wants them to raise that track bar. They dropped it a few laps ago, Larry Mack. They want it back the way they had it. Four tires again for Sterling Marlin in the 40 car. Let's go to Matt Yoakum.
And Mark Martin looking for his third Rockingham win. No adjustments on the sixth car. He said, leave it like it is, Ben. Today.
Rusty Wallace again calls for no changes. Another four-tire stop right behind him. Bobby Labonte came into this pit stop running in second position. He is looking for a little bit more bite in his car. Rusty, first off pit road, followed by the six of Mark Martin again.
Long stop for Blaney there.
I think he must be making some of those adjustments, yep. Taking some spring rubbers out or something.
And you know, Mark Martin, remember the last stop as well, he didn't want any adjustments. He lost a lot of ground, as you see him still working on Kenny Wallace, the 23 car here on pit road. But his car looked like after about 10 laps, it started really coming in, and he was just as quick as the leaders. Sterling Marlin evidently was a little bit loose. They dropped that track bar. It's like, you hadn't tightened me up. Now I'm pushing in loose, raise it back up.
And you know, Mike, one thing we always, I used to do a lot of rookie orientation meetings at the track, and we'd always tell them, when we leave here, nobody wants to mention your name. That's a good day.
Right. The Subway 400 on Fox is brought to you by Subway. Fresh made sandwiches on fresh baked bread. Subway. Eat fresh. Kenny Wallace now joins the cars laps down. There are three of them, Larry Foyt, Kenny Wallace, Tony Raines, Todd Bodine, Derek Cope in the garage. We're set to go back to green at 111 laps. Tough pit stop for Bill Elliott. He's back in 19th after running with the leaders all day. It'll be Wallace, Martin, Bobby Labonte, Busch, and Stewart as they come to the green.
Ready. Green flag, green flag.
I might see this thing go green for a while with you, Larry, just see who's got the best car, because we really can't tell you.
That's when it shows up, about 50, 60 laps. We look at a pit stop summary right here. There you see Rusty Wallace in first, out first. Sterling Marlin, a little bit of a loser right there, fifth to eighth. Got a second page right here. You'll see Bill Elliott right there from 10th to 19th and Ryan Newman from 7th to 12th. So they were the real losers. Tony Stewart now in the top five here, 113 laps into this race.
And you got to believe, Larry, when you see good teams like that fall back like that, they must have made some kind of major chassis adjustment, maybe spring rubbers or something that held them up a little bit in the pit.
It don't take long.
Let's get an update on those stops from pit road. Dick Bergeron.
Rusty Wallace has clicked off some great pit stops today, Mike. Billy Wilburn, his crew chief, is also the front tire man. He has been calling instructions to the rest of the crew from pit wall, literally, as he jumps over. Mr. Matty.
Dick, no adjustments for Tony Stewart. He said he just feels like they can't tighten the car up anymore in the center. No adjustments, but they are talking about what changes to make on their next stop. They realize there's a lot of laps left to run. They don't want to start dialing themselves out this early. They're going to wait and see. Steve?
Well, Matt Kenseth likes his race car. No adjustments to that number 17, but he told his spotter, I'm having a hard time seeing out the back. Don't get me wrecked. The team put a new support bracket across the back windshield. He's having a hard time seeing. Jeannie Zelasco.
Well, Jimmy Johnson's crew chief, Chad Canales, told me this morning that today would be a little bit of a science project because of the lack of track time. One of the things they've already learned from this last pit stop, the right front tire has way more buildup than they want. They're going to have to go with a little lower air pressure in the next set of tires that they put on.
One thing about you, somebody can't see out the back, as it gets later in the afternoon, the sun goes down on the west over here, it gets harder and harder to see going down in the first turn as well. Used to, without the tear-offs, that just became a real obstacle, and you almost went in there blind with the spotter helping you.
One enhancement we've added to our coverage this year, folks, we're going to put some race notes in here that you'll see right below the running order on our Fox box to help keep you up to date with what's happened in the race so far. 117 laps complete. Rusty Wallace in front.
I mean, that's neat. I mean, we try to do a good job, and our guys helping us up here in the booth of giving you things that happen early in the race, but sometimes we can't cover them all. All you have to do is look up there below the Fox box.
Gosh, I just always felt like we were a wealth of information, but I guess there's things that even we don't see.
You mean like for fifth right here?
Like this battle for fifth place. Now, ever since the drop of the green flag on the restart, Ricky Craven's been on the high side. Meanwhile, Tony Stewart's been working the bottom, gaining a bit of ground. Until just now, when Matt Kenseth gets past him.
You know, a guy that we were talking about early, part of the Richard Childress Racing Group, our Daytona 500 pole sitter, started back in 39th on that competition caution at lap 45. He was about to go a lap down Jeff Green in the 30 car. Mike Bean, his new crew chief, I think they have made the right adjustments on that car, and he's up to 14th now, so he definitely went from being a bad race car to a pretty good race car.
Well, you would think Mike Bean was here with the 32 car last year, and as good as Ricky Craven's runs here, you'd think that that parlay into a good setup for him for a green, but maybe the Chevrolet is that much different, because they did have a Ford here last year.
Blaney, the pole sitter for this race, right behind Jeff Green, the pole sitter in Daytona.
Oh, trouble down here, guys, going around. So one car.
They do.
He saves it.
He got a little push. Here comes Jeremy. He got hit from the back.
All right, clear high.
Caution's out.
So Jeremy got run into. He slowed down and he got run into from the back.
Lap 122, fourth caution of the day.
The old one car got bumped in the rear. I didn't catch who
did it. Never hit anything. Just get ready to knock the valance out a little bit. Other than that, nothing.
See if we can see what happened here. You see the old one car's down low coming off of turn four here, and somebody nerfs him from the back. Here he comes right back here. There you go. Yikes.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the 8 car, the Budweiser car.
June bug.
Roof flaps come up. While this is happening, Jeremy Mayfield in the 19. He gets tapped.
Yeah, you can see the damage on the rear of his car. He checked up, and somebody ran in the back of him and spun him out.
Now, just before this, watch Tony Raines' car on the left of your screen in front of Dale Jarrett. Little piece of trim.
That looked like, you know what that looked like? He's got damage in the rear. That's the bumper bar that goes up inside the rear bumper.
Guess what? 10 laps on our tires, pit now. Four tires.
Jeannie?
Jimmy Johnson taking advantage of this stop, getting four tires. He's talking, of course, about the tire pressure and getting this just right. The young team working on it. Steve?
J.D. Sterling Marlin, they'll drop a half a pound out of the right front tire. Greg Pozzi, the jack man, gets car up. Let's go to Matt.
And Steve, for the third stop here on pit road of no adjustments for Mark Martin. He says the car, still great, no adjustments, Ben, to Dick Bergeron.
Tim Boatwright, the jack man, has already come around from the right side of the car to the left. They've got the right side tires on. Boom, another great stop by Rusty Wallace.
and one collision on pit road. Robbie Gordon exiting his pit got into the side of somebody.
But this wad right here coming out right now, there's where the action was. I saw tire smoke, people running into each other.
All right, what these times are right here, that's time on the pit road and off of pit road, including a stop. And here you see Joe Nemechek and his group, they had a good stop.
Now 37.6 seconds total pit road time. Now let's go back to Jerry Nadeau, who became a proud first-time father on Monday. New daughter, Natalie.
Actually spun out qualifying on Friday without any help. Dale Jr. here, and doesn't take much, just a little. What happened, I think Nadeau got back in the gas, car got a little loose, Jr. had a run on him, tapped him around.
This is looking out the back of Jerry Nadeau's car. I mean, the car's sliding around anyhow. It don't take much of a hit to send you around.
But you could hear the engine. He got back in the throttle. He squeezed up a little bit. When he did, Jr. got in the back of it.
And he kept it off the wall. Now, Jeremy Mayfield's view.
Could be the 43 car. I didn't get a good shot of who was behind Jeremy. There he goes.
Got booted. Now let's show you what happened on pit road exiting.
Right down here.
Here comes Gordon out.
It's on a little further down. All of a sudden they all bottleneck up right there. You go.
Boy, Robbie Gordon in the 31 just almost got in the back of Sterling Marlin.
Yeah, no contact, but a lot of tire smoke, brakes locking up there as everybody tries to get to that outside lane and off pit road.
It's a little bit of a product also of that pit road going in a curve down there at the 1 and 2. There's a lot of blind spots.
Sometimes you got to be careful what you ask for, I believe, and this is a good example of it. This pit road, the way it is and as narrow as it is with it in the curve like it is down there, it's not a very good situation.
See, John Andretti, the 43 car, you saw him behind the wall. There's his car owner, Richard Petty, checking things out as well.
That's where he hit Jeremy in the rear end, I believe.
Dick Bergeron with more on our third place driver, Bobby Labonte.
Now, Fatback McSwain, his crew chief, has been on the radio exhorting the crew to pick it up on the pit stops. Not that they've done badly, but Bobby Labonte keyed his radio just a little while ago and told them that he thought this race today would be won in the pits, and he could well be the winner at his last four spring starts here at Rockingham. Labonte has finished third, first, second, third, and right now he's running third.
Well, one thing we've seen so far, Dick, it can be lost in the pits. If these guys keep running over each other the way they are.
Not a lot of lap cars to deal with right now. Just Larry Ford to 14, Tony Raines in the 74 right now on the inside line.
Speed building as they go down the back straightaway. Rusty Wallace, Mark.
This is the same thing we saw after the last restart, though. Mark's car just maybe don't get going on a restart like it should, but it starts coming in about 10 or 12 laps into a run.
If we ever get into a routine here and, you know, make some long runs, I think that'll pay off for Mark.
And they haven't been making many adjustments on that car. I guarantee you Mark's beating on that steering wheel every time that caution flag comes out. He wants those long runs.
And here's another factor. Rusty Wallace has not won a race in over a year. He's got a fast hot rod today. And where's the safest place to be?
Way out front. Way out front.
Steve Burns.
Mike Joy, the crew furiously trying to get the radiator out of that number 43 Dodge. There's damage to the right front corner. They're pulling the sheet metal away. They're going to have to put a brand new radiator in the 43.
Not the way you wanted your 300th career start to go. Robbie Gordon makes his 100th start today, and Rusty his 600th.
I got to throw this out there. It's one of those things I looked up in the book. Kurt Busch has made 79 starts, and he's 39th on the all-time money list already.
Wow.
With over $8 million.
I tell you, these guys, they get those fresh tires. They'll feel racy for about 10 laps. I mean, we're seeing three-wide racing a lot of places around this racetrack.
You'd be feeling like a hero when you got those four good Eagles up under you.
Like Superman putting on his cape.
That's right.
Four fresh tires.
You can hear these guys with that throttle.
Yeah.
You drive that car as much with the throttle pedal as you do the steering wheel.
Look at Johnny Benson, his last green flag lap before the pit stops versus the speed he's running now.
And you heard Jeff Hammond talking earlier, that equates out to about a second and a half to 2 seconds difference.
Rusty Wallace hungry for his first win in more than a year, leading Mark Martin, Bobby Labonte, Kurt Busch, and Ricky Kraemer. The Subway 400 on Fox is brought to you by Pontiac, fuel for the soul. By Aaron's Sales and Lease Ownership, let Aaron's drive your dreams home today. By Stacker 2, the world's strongest fat burner. And by Discover to Go, it pays to discover. 137 laps, Rusty Wallace with a 3/4 second lead. And everybody chasing using a variety of lines around the racetrack. You're riding with Kevin Harvick. And a few laps ago, he and Steve Hart tried racing for the same part of racetrack. There's the yellow number one of Park.
And you see the smoke fly, and then Harvick said, that wasn't necessary.
Things that go,
I think I'm gonna get that boy. And here he comes off the corner, and runs up there, and he says, hello. It's the old Earnhardt theory. You hit me once, I'll hit you twice.
Childress Racing versus Earnhardt Incorporated. And unlike Daytona, neither of those Chevy teams doing much today.
Yeah, I mean, when you see the highest finishing of those, or highest running of those six cars being 20th, Robbie Gordon, that is a far distance from Daytona. You know, a guy that is having a good run here today, and back in the mid-90s, when he first started driving for Bill Davis, won his first race here in the fall of 95, Ward Burton in that 22 car right there. Started 15th. I talked to Frankie Stoddard. These guys just totally missed the setup both races here last year. They didn't come here and test, but they felt pretty good, and he's up there running in an eighth. About where you expect Ward to be running, Matt Yoakum.
Well, Larry Mack, Lee Robertson watches as the 22 car goes by, but he can only see just a little bit of Ward on the racetrack. But his invention, which debuted at Daytona, allows crew chief Frank Stoddard to see a lot more. Actually, it's a hoist built into the pit box. It extends up 7 feet from the top of the pit box. So if Frankie cannot look down and see, he can just raise it up a little more. You can see he's high atop everyone else. What a great view.
Boy, I tell you, Matt, Darrell, Mike, pit boxes have come a long way. I remember sitting in a director's chair on the ground for a number of years. Some of those pit boxes, they need a fuel permit just to move them around.
Oh, I know. My poor wife sat out in the cold and the sun and everything else under an umbrella.
Now, two teammates that have done everything but work together.
Long run, nice and smooth.
Jimmy Johnson and Jeff Gordon. Johnson was running the top in turns 3 and 4, while Gordon was trying the bottom. Now they're kind of running the same line, but Gordon has not been making a lot of inroads on 10th place. There they both sweep up high this time.
They're working a lot more together this weekend. I think I've seen them before. They even in the pits, they're pitting very close together, and they seem to be running together a lot on the racetrack.
Dave Blaney, our pole sitter, running a solid 15th after fading back in the early stage of the race. Dick.
And he's picking up spots, Mike. The chassis had not been working to their satisfaction, but crew chief Booty Barker is one of the acknowledged chassis experts. They've taken a little extra time on some of their pit stops to try to get that chassis dialed in. Blaney now starting to move forward.
Hey, guy, Larry and I were just noticing, I think he's doing a great job, and I credit his crew chief, Donnie Wingo, for working with Jamie McMurray. He's in eighth place. That car looks mighty, mighty racy. And I think Donnie's doing a really good job over there with that rookie.
I mean, Donnie's been around so long, worked with Jimmy Means, worked for Bud Moore, worked over Travis Carter's with Jimmy Spencer. Yeah, Donnie Wingo don't get near enough credit for what he does in this garage area and on pit road.
Trust me, I was up there at Travis's when he was up there with Spencer and all, and the man is a hard worker and he's pretty darn smart.
And McMurray's been on the charge. Every time they've dropped the green today, he's been firing out of the pack. And I don't think I've seen anybody pass him all day, but he's been doing his share.
And I have to say this because I have to be honest. You know, I never had noticed Jamie McMurray. And then Chip Ganassi signs him last fall. immediately, not only when he climbs in that 40 car does he win a race in competitive, his Busch program, it's like it put confidence in that kid when Chip Ganassi signed him to drive a race car.
Some owners, Jack Roush is a good example, and certainly Chip is another one. You look at his IndyCar program and everything else. Just they got a knack for picking the talent.
And you know, we talked about this the other day, qualifying. When you looked at the top 10, it was veterans. And the only young gun that qualified the top 10 was Jamie McMurray.
You know why? Here we had limited practice. We're here, and I can't say enough about going back to that old notebook. This track is a little bit hard to get used to if you haven't been here before. And I think that's why some of the veterans and the veteran teams are performing as well as they have been.
Well, it's all veterans at the front of the pack. Rusty Wallace, Mark Martin, and Bobby Labonte are the first three in the Subway 400 on Fox.
Fox welcomes you back to Rockingham, North Carolina, the Subway 400. And today's aerial coverage provided by Budweiser. As you see, Rusty Wallace, the leader, with Jeff Hammond, Chris Myers, as we look down upon Rusty Wallace. And you know, the last time he led the most laps in a race was at Kansas in September of 2001, but the driver leading the most laps has failed to win this race 12 of the last 15 times.
Now, that might be the case right now, Chris, but I believe you me. I believe the communication between Bill Wilbur and Rusty Wallace and this whole Penske organization right now with this new Dodge product, they may be their day to get back in victory lane. I think he's doing a great job. The car seemed like it's working well. They seem like they've really got their act together.
All right, let's listen in to a little audio.
190 on the water, 230 on the oil. 10-4, copy.
Real good, RW, real good.
Well, right there, you see it right now, how calm and cool Rusty is right now. He's calling into his pits, letting him know what the water temperature is and the oil temperature. And you heard his spotter, I believe, up on top talking about how good he looked. The car's really stable. Like, he can run any way he wants to on this racetrack, whether it's be high or low. I mean, he just seems like he's really relaxed right now at this point of the race.
Yeah, it looks to me like his car's handling like I like for him to handle.
Yeah, right now, you keep talking about how you want to take it off in the corner, and you know yourself, Darrell, you want to let the car just float off in the corner, get out of the throttle early, and kind of like this, I mean, just barely turn the steering wheel and ease back into the gas. And again, I talked to Bill Wilburn this morning, and he was adamant about one thing. He said the amount of practice that we got was just enough to get a direction on this race car. They feel very confident that they had the right setup, and so far he's got it right where he wants it.
And Jeff and Darrell, he is within about 4 or 5 seconds of catching a gaggle of cars, and that's when he has to start maneuvering that car around. He can't run the line he wants to then.
Yeah, well, what I was telling Jeff was it's handling like I like from handling. It's handling down that straightaway. I mean, he does look so smooth through the turn, but that Dodge engine, they're turning at about 9,200. I'm sure he's got a lot of gear laid up in that thing, and it's really paying off for him.
Roger Penske looking on. The owner of Rusty Wallace and Ryan Newman's Dodges. Switched from Ford to Dodge this year.
Got to make you, these car owners amaze me. Like Chip Ganassi and Jack Roush and Roger Penske, they make changes, and you say, oh, that's not a very good idea. And they end up looking like heroes.
I tell you, two cars that seem to have about the best two cars on the racetrack right now, Kurt Busch in the 97, Ward Burton in the 22. Look at the line difference right there. Kurt Busch all the way against the wall, Ward Burton in that 22 car hugging that white line.
Again, I just refer back to gear selection, Larry. You know, if you got a pretty low gear in the car, you can hang that bottom and accelerate up off the corner. Got a little higher gear in the car, you can run the top and get good speed up off the corner. So, but I think Rusty has got the best combination of everything, whatever he's got.
Got something new for the folks, DW. In addition to running order, we're going to show you how many laps until they make their next pit stop.
I like that. Me and Hammond could have used that. Of course, I would have said he wasn't right, but.
Now, just to clarify one thing, most racetracks we go to, that's going to be a fuel number. But based on what we know about the tire give up here, what most of these teams are thinking, that's kind of based on their tire strategy right there. They can go further than that on the fuel if they need to.
But, you know, we haven't made a long run. We haven't made it to a fuel window yet. So we're going to have to see how things play out here.
We see the 9 of Bill Elliott. He has now dropped back to be the last car on the lead lap. Maybe not for long. That's Rusty Wallace looming in Bill's rearview mirror.
There you see our fuel tanks on Rusty Wallace, Mark Martin, and Bobby Labonte. They have plenty of fuel, a little over half. But I don't think you'll ever get to that E unless it's at the end of the race when you have to.
Well, I think Rusty will come first and Mark will come last, whatever that turns out to be.
Well, the thing about it, it's you have to do what your competitor's doing, because if they come to pit road, say the first or second place guy come to pit road, you can't sit out there and give that 2 seconds a lap up. That's when you'll see everybody come.
The thing is that worries me here, though, Larry, and it keeps me on my toes, is so long to make a green flag stop. You're going to lose almost 2 laps when you do come.
Because of how long pit road is. You can be a hero or you can be a zero.
And right here we're seeing the effect of who's handling and who's not, as Rusty Wallace puts a lap on Bill Elliott, Jeremy Mayfield, and Robbie Gordon. Bill Elliott is reporting in. His car is just too tight.
And again, we go through the track change. He started to race up front. Car looked pretty good. He's running second at one time. But now they've got rubber down. Now the car's too tight.
Rusty Wallace picking them up and mowing them down here, leading Mark Martin, Bobby Labonte, Kurt Busch, and Ward Burton.
Fox welcomes you back to Rockingham, North Carolina, the Subway 400. Rusty Wallace, your leader, but our fifth caution out on lap 174. Dale Earnhardt Jr. having some problems. And Jeff Hammond, does a driver, when you go back even to the Daytona 500, when they had the battery electrical problems and then the frustration here, does that start to mount when we see something like this? This was moments ago in the car of the lead.
Yeah, I think sometimes you start trying to put pressure on yourself, knowing you need to have a good run, and all of a sudden you run into problems like you did early on, getting the fender messed up, losing laps there. Now you're spinning up off the corner right there. This is not what you want to see as far as you want to think about trying to win the championship. You know, it's early in the season, but you don't want to wind up getting that situation right there.
All right, let's go down trackside, check in with Jeannie Zalasco.
Standing in the pit of Jamie McMurray, the 42 car has been loose all the way around, so they were talking about tire pressure adjustments. Fuel tank 4 and fuel. Steve?
Half a pound out of the right front, an air pressure adjustment for Matt Kenseth. Half a turn down in the right rear spring. Matt Yoakum.
A wedge adjustment and air pressure adjustment for Mark Martin. Service complete, another great stop. Nick.
Rusty Wallace is going to make the first adjustment of the day on his race car. The car was a little bit loose in. They've changed 1 pound of air pressure. The race off pit road again.
A close one, but Mark Martin looks like he beat Wallace off pit road. There are the pit road
yeah.
times.
And just barely, because look at that, 44.7 to 44.2.
But look at Kurt Busch and look at Ward Burton. Those guys had the quickest pit road time.
Guy's been making killer pit stops is back down here in front of us, the 48 car.
And what that is, that's coming onto pit road and leaving pit road, including the pit stop.
But the problem with that is he's way down here and he can't make any time down the pit lane. People keep pulling out in front of him.
So the caution is out for Dale Earnhardt Jr., who spun harmlessly off turn number 2. Fifth caution of the day. Subway 400 on Fox is brought to you by UPS, official delivery company of NASCAR. We want to race the truck. People love the truck. Restart at lap 179, and what a knot of cars at the front of the pack behind Rusty Wallace.
And you see what I was talking about, Rusty's car? He is so fast down the straightaway. I mean, he is really moving down the straightaway. Just drove right under Mark and went on by him.
Of course, you got Bill Elliott in the 9 and his teammate Jeremy Mayfield in the 19, along with Dale Earnhardt Jr. with this group, trying to catch a caution to get that lap back.
Now, earlier when Dale Earnhardt Jr. had his spin, we'll pick up some audio.
Keep an eye on that A car. He's crazy loose up there in front of you. Next car off.
Tap off.
And Junior was indeed loose. A single car spin.
And it just comes right out from under you. And off of that corner, it's a little bit of dip in that turn right there, and they'll come around on you in a heartbeat.
Plus, Darrell, I'm sure he was starting to overdrive his race car because he's about to go a lap down.
Now look what happens in all this to that orange Chevrolet of Tony Stewart. The left front fender gets all banged up because right behind Junior, you'll see Kyle Petty come into view and then Stewart.
It's Tony right there.
Matt Yoakum.
Mike, they did cut away about a 2-inch by 11-inch section of sheet metal on that left front, and basically they put a huge tape patch on there to try to help that race car's damage. They're not going to know how severe the damage is aero-wise until he runs a few laps. But Tom Dean was on the wall. They were contemplating pitting again, but they just ran out of time under that caution, putting one more big piece of tape on the front.
If there's a corner that's critical on the front of a car, the left front here is critical because that's the corner you want to keep planted. That's the one that makes these cars turn through the corner. Anything distorted or a hole in it's going to hurt these cars turning.
So sometimes I have had trouble like that, Larry, and I was so loose that I couldn't drive my car. Then I'd tear up my fender, and all of a sudden I wasn't loose anymore.
Cooling that left front tire, too.
That's right.
All right, let's look at our pit stop graphic from that last round of pit stops. Let's see who the winners and the losers were. There you see Rusty Wallace in first, second. But look down here at Tony Stewart. In 24th, out 32nd. Mark Martin was the real gainer on it, going from second to first.
Kurt Busch closing in on his Roush Racing teammate Mark Martin and going to the outside for second place.
We saw that race here last fall. These two guys kind of went at it. I think that Mark has definitely shared the wealth as far as how you get around marking him.
But I'm going to tell you what, Kurt Busch, he's got where it don't matter where we go, he's competitive. In fact, going all the way back to Martinsville in the fall, he has finished sixth or better in every race that he's been in.
And all of a sudden, look, last week at Daytona, they throw the red flag and he's sitting in second place.
As he closes in on our race leader, Rusty Wallace, here's Dick.
Well, Rob Fuller, who is the rear tire changer for Rusty Wallace, simply could not believe that they have twice been beaten by Mark Martin coming off pit road today. So we took a look at the pit map and figured out that Mark Martin has got an opening in front of his pit, not in his head, and they figured out that's why Mark has beaten him off pit road. To Matty.
And Dick, with the trouble by Dale Earnhardt Jr., it also gives him an easy entrance into his pit stall. One comment Mark Martin told Ben Leslie's crew chief, he said, these guys are running a lot harder at the get-go of a run than I really want to run. He says, we are good, but we're not as good as we look. That's why they made the wedge adjustment and the air pressure adjustment on the last stop, trying to make that good race car great.
Yeah, Mark said earlier in the weekend he wanted his car to be good 20 or 30 laps
on pit road run.
We hear he has a flat tire. He'll probably go at least two laps down. Remember, 45 miles an hour, and that can seem like it takes forever getting down this pit road under green.
Well, let's see how much time he actually loses, Larry. He came in right there in the thick of things. Let's see where he goes back out.
Well, here comes Bobby Labonte down pit road. They're not entirely sure what's wrong. He has a vibration. They believe the problem is on the right side. Possible flat tire, maybe a tire that's loose. They just don't know. What a disappointment. Labonte had run with the leaders. He is now a lap down. Rusty Wallace has just flown on by him. They're going to change all four just to make sure. And this is going to make it very difficult for Bobby Labonte to win this race today.
Leaving the pits there. He's just now going out back out onto the back straightaway, and here comes Rusty to the line now. So he lost a lap and a half.
So it's Wallace, Busch, Martin, Burton, Ward Burton, Craven, McMurray, and then, you know, Dale Jarrett running in seventh.
Yeah, I was gonna say Dale Jarrett qualified ninth here. We're riding aboard with Dale Jarrett, but he slipped way back when the race started. But I think it's one of those cases they've been adjusting on that car. Now he's back in the top 10.
Yeah, Brad Parrott, I heard him say that the 38 car, Elliott Sadler, came down here and tested. He said, you know, Dale didn't run that good here last fall. We're just going to put the 38 car set up under Dale's car today.
And what our guys from the pits are telling me, he's been loose all day long, and they've been slowly adjusting. And the reason you want to be careful in adjusting a loose race car, you know this racetrack will tighten up the more rubber that gets put down on it. There you see his interval in the top right corner. He was gaining just a little bit on our leader, Rusty Wallace.
Here's the thing that you can bet. Rusty might be sitting up here saying, I'm not going to run, but so hard. But that cat behind him, he's driving it for all it's worth.
Kurt Busch looking low on Wallace once again in turn three for the lead.
He's after him with the gusto of a hungry hound, I can tell you that.
This may or may not allow Mark Martin to close up.
No, I think Mark's getting his money's worth right now. Nice seat, you know. Good place to watch a race from right here.
I tell you, Bobby Labonte, even though he has a little fresher tires than these guys, there he is right there. He's about a lap and a half behind the leader, but he's running about 3 or 4 tenths quicker than the leader. But the thing he needs cautions where maybe he can get that lap made up. There you see his Fox track right there at 125 miles an hour down in the middle of turn 3 and 4.
Now, one thing that will help him eventually is if it'll cycle all the way through and these other guys have got to make green flag stops, he'll be able to stay out a little bit longer and have a better chance to get that lap back.
There you see just how much faster he is than the leader, and that's just 10 laps less on his tires. That just shows you how important tires are here. Fresh tires. There's a set of fresh tires.
Stickers.
Kurt Busch hounding Rusty Wallace for the lead in the Subway 400 on Fox. The Subway 400 on Fox is brought to you by Subway, where racing fans go for delicious, fresh-made sandwiches. Subway, eat fresh. By Radio Shack, you've got questions, we've got answers. By Visa, the official card of NASCAR. And by Lowe's Home Improvement Warehouse. Lowe's, improving home improvement. 202 laps just past halfway, and the only change in the front five is Ricky Craven, who has moved past Ward Burton for fourth. Kurt Busch got to Rusty Wallace, but couldn't get through Rusty Wallace.
And Mark just sits there and is just patiently. Man's got more patience than Job. He just sits there and waits.
But right now, a little over 25 laps in this run, he's about a tenth or two quicker than those guys up there running first and second, Rusty Wallace and Kurt Busch. He's just lurking.
Yes, he is.
But this is a typical Rockingham. We're just past the halfway, and even though we've had five cautions, 41 of the cars of the 43 that started this race are back in. John Andretti's back out there. The only two out is Todd Bodine and Derek Coate.
One of the fastest cars on the track is this one, Ricky Craven's Pontiac, which just moved up into fourth place.
Looks like maybe they got the adjustment off a little bit. A few pit stops ago on this car. Now they've got it coming back their direction.
And you can think that that probably be normal, Larry. That's a new car, a new body style for them. Pontiac, they had Fords last year, going through a learning curve.
You look at our Fox tracks, the interval right there, he's chopping it down right now on our leader, Rusty Wallace, down to 4.5 seconds.
Two cars behind him, Dale Jarrett, running in sixth place, 5.5 seconds off the lead. And we picked up this exchange.
560, position 7, minus 4 seconds. You're quicker than everybody. There's a long run here, tire management.
Every time I ever heard that you're quicker than everybody, I said, well, how come I'm not catching them then?
Or how come they're getting smaller?
Yeah, how come they keep getting smaller? I'm not catching anybody.
Well, he's catching Ward Burton and passes Ward for fifth place. And right behind them lurks the 42 of Jamie McMurray, who's probably passed more cars than anybody today, coming out of the pack on each restart. He is seventh. And behind him, the man who won this race 1 year ago, Matt Kenseth, back to the lead. Kurt Busch is there.
I know Rusty's sitting there saying, kid, just calm down. Just take it easy. We got a long way to go yet. And Rusty's up here saying, ride a little bit. And the kid's saying, race, 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 race. Mark's sitting back here saying, side-by-side racing? I've known that to cause a problem.
Of course, Kurt Busch has not led yet in this race, so he'd like to lead a lap to get those 5 bonus points.
Don't look at me like that. I, exactly what they're saying. I know what they're saying.
I believe you.
I know what both those guys are saying.
All right, well, if you're Rusty, Darrell, why not just let him go?
Because you haven't won a race in over a year.
Good reason.
And you switched to Dodge, and your boss, Roger Penske, sent overhead up here. I could go on and on.
And if you're Kurt Busch, you won 3 of the last 6 races, finished second 1 week ago, and you want to lead the points leaving here.
That's right, and he's working old Rusty over.
He still has not led a lap. Rusty's been edging him at the start-finish line every lap over the last 5 laps.
Horsepower. Get that horsepower down that straightaway.
5 different leaders today. Wallace, Mark Martin, Ricky Craven, pole sitter Dave Blaney, and Kyle Petty led a lap under caution.
Look at that thing go down that straightaway. I mean, that pulls away from him.
There you see we have the graphic on Kurt Busch, laps to the next pit stop, about 37 laps. And once again, as we talked about earlier, this is not for fuel. This is based on the tire strategy that these teams have talked about using today.
Second at Daytona, runner up in the points. And right now, he's moved to the point lead.
And I was talking about horsepower, and it just made me, I remember Tommy Turner, that used to work over at Holman Moody, did a lot of engine work for the Wood Brothers through the years. Tommy's not doing real well right now, and I just wanted to give him a big high and cheer him up a little bit and let me know he's thinking about him.
But you know, Darrell, you talked about Rusty Hanlon down the straightaway, and that's certainly not to take anything away from the chassis setup that Bill Wilburn and those guys. But I know as the Penske organization was looking at this change from the Ford to the Dodge, they were outweighing a lot of things there, you know, business decisions as well. But I know they really put it on the shoulders of the engine guys and said, hey, can you make as much power with these Dodge motors as you've been making with those Ford motors? It looked like they've accomplished it.
About 10.
Larry Wallace and that group over Penske Jasper engines as we look at Dave Blaney in the Jasper car, the 77 car.
Dick Bergman with more on the pole sitter.
Hey, that pole sitter is moving forward. Blaney right now is running in the eighth position. The car is not perfect. It's a bit loose. He's solving that problem by backing off a little earlier and getting on the gas sooner. Come at him.
Well, Dick, let's update Matt Kenseth in the 17. He led 152 laps last year on the way to his win, but when he hit pit road after the last caution on lap 173, they took a half a pound out of the right front, and he said, guys, I'm struggling. That adjustment made us just a little too loose. Jeannie.
Everyone else, Jeff Gordon missed out on track time due to weather. Crew chief Robbie Lumen said he was not concerned because his driver would find a groove in the track that would work for him. We can rule one thing out. Jeff Gordon is having problems running on the bottom. He says, quote, the car is pushing like crazy.
You know, Larry, this and Mike, this is a classic slow down and go faster racetrack. You let off the gas, you start letting off the gas real early, and all of a sudden your lap times improve.
Look at Elliott Sadler's day. He has been as high as third, and he's been as low as 40th.
But again, that's not because I think of the car's performance. It's because they were making those pit stops trying to repair that front end, that grill work. That's one reason he was down slow in the running order.
Rusty Wallace continues to hold off the advances of Kurt Busch. Mark Martin, Ricky Craven, and Dale Jarrett are your top five in the Subway 400. Kurt Busch hounded Rusty for the lead. You see Rusty coming up on a big pack of lap traffic here. Busch has a look. Look at that cluster up ahead.
Yeah, what I've been noticing about Rusty, Larry, is he's getting a little loose off, which is going to cause him to have to backpedal just a little bit up out of the corner. So I think that's what's happened to him.
That got Kurt Busch the lead. Time now for the Pepsi fan cam. A sudden but windswept day.
Man, Rusty just about spun out, y'all.
He's gonna lose second place to Mark.
His car's gotten really bad loose. I'm sorry, Mike, I didn't mean to jump on you like that, but he turned it plumb sideways. His car's gotten loose off, and he just about spun that thing out.
Trying to get back around Martin and retake second spot. Let's show you what happened.
You'll see why I jumped on you. Watch this. Coming here, coming under the 41, right about there. Oh, that baby did a number on
him. And he tried to turn it down to go under Casey Mears in the 41. That's when it got loose with him. Pinched it down. He's went back by Mark Martin to get back into second place.
That's it, bud. Take a deep breath. Get back in your rhythm.
Rusty Spotter just telling him, hey, shake it off. Let's go. Find that groove again.
And they've now fallen a second and a half behind Kurt Busch.
Larry and Darrell, from what I can figure out now, these guys are about 20 laps when they should be starting making their normal pit stops. So it'll be real interesting to see how much more they drop off and how this separation kind of comes about. Because as you're saying, Rusty needs tires and he's just about going to have to come get them pretty soon.
Now lapping has begun. You saw them get past Casey Mears. Joe Nemechek is next ahead, then Jerry Nadeau, Terry Labonte, Kevin Harvick.
Hey, Jeff, I'll tell you something, OTIDE is looking pretty good too. He's rolled up there right behind Mark Martin, and he's coming on pretty strong here at the end of a long run.
Well, Jeff and Darrell, I've been sitting up here, if you can believe this, with my calculator doing some figuring. And we're all went back racing at 177, so we can run about 70 laps three times to get to the end of the race. Should it stay green? And you know what? Rockingham, this part of the race, always has that nature of long green runs. So I'm going to run you 70, 70, and 70 should we stay green, Jeff.
Well, we must be on the same wavelength right now, Larry. That's exactly what I've been coming up with here, figuring 70, 70. That would be a good number right now to try to work toward. But I think it's going to be real critical for these guys to make these adjustments based off of this run toward the end and let the driver kind of take care of the tires in the first part of a run, because at the tail end of a run, you're going to lose the most amount of time.
230 laps as Kurt Busch tries to get past Kenny Wallace, who was already three laps back after his spin and crash on the back straightaway.
And right now, 2 seconds behind Kurt Busch, Rusty Wallace, he's having a heck of a time with Casey Mears in the 41 car. He just can't quite get by him. And meanwhile, Ricky Craven has caught Mark Martin and Rusty Wallace while they've been fighting Casey Mears in the 41 car.
Of the top 14 cars, they're all quicker than second place Rusty Wallace right now on that last lap.
Yeah, and Rusty's really getting aggravated with the 41 car. I mean, he's trying to put him a lap down, and he really held him up.
But you know the thing about it, Casey's already a lap down because Kurt Busch put him a lap down.
Yeah, but he's if you look on the back of his car, he's a rookie. And he's racing for everybody for just like he was leading the race.
Pit stops have begun. Kyle Petty, John Andretti, Tony Raines, and Dale Earnhardt Jr. have all been on pit road.
And if you notice, the guys that are pitting, they're the guys that are lapped down. What their hopes are is this stays green and they get the advantage of those fresh tires a lot longer than the guys that's up there leading the race. Maybe they'll get their lap made up.
I really like the way that Ricky Craven is coming on here at the end of this long run, Larry. That could really be big as we go into this latter part of this race, latter part of the race here.
Craven is
really working.
Yep, slices right past Rusty. That's second place. And Dale Jarrett has closed right up on that pack.
Yeah, he's in fifth place now, so they definitely have got that car tightened up. We were talking earlier, his car was loose at the beginning of this race. But I think also they've made some adjustments, but I think this racetrack is getting tighter too.
Well, and that could be Rusty's problem. I mean, Rusty has been the dominant car, but from about two-thirds to the end of this race, this track goes to a huge transition, and you've got to make adjustments to keep up with it.
Pit stops in about 13 laps for most of the cars. And we'll show you Rusty Wallace's lap times at approximately 10-lap intervals, and you see how they have climbed half a second or so.
And see, right now, the crew chief's telling Rusty, just hang on a few more laps. We need to get to 70 laps so we can do what Larry said. But he's probably squealing right now because everybody's going by him.
Dick Bergeron's in Rusty's pit
with Billy Wilburn, the crew chief. Billy, what's wrong with that car?
Well, we're just a little loose right now. We've run a little longer than we've run all day. We're probably going to pit here in about 15 laps, get some tires, make an adjustment, put some wedge in it, maybe a tire pressure adjustment also.
Okay, cars look good till this point, Mike.
Thanks, Dick. Kurt Busch laps past 25 of Joe Nemechek, and that will leave us 29 cars on the lead lap.
Now, one thing that Rusty has to be real careful of, and Bill too, is that they don't over adjust their car when they come down pit road.
Looking out the back of Kevin Harvick in the 29 car, he's about to go a lap down. His job right now is to stay on the lead lap. Kurt Busch is letting him know, hey, I'm faster than you. I'm going to go by you on the outside. And he's Kevin Harvick. That's good strategy. Go a lap down, come to pit road, get your four fresh tires, get the advantage of those four fresh tires.
So green flag pit stops have begun as we follow Kevin Harvick down pit road. Kurt Busch leads Ricky Craven by 2.8 seconds. Then DJ, Mark and Matt, Rusty Wallace has slid to sixth. Then pole sitter Dave Blaney, Jamie McMurray, Jeff Gordon and Jimmy Johnson. The Subway 400 on Fox is brought to you by Chevrolet. Wherever there's a winner's circle, we'll be there. And by Advance Auto Parts. We're ready in advance. Advance Auto Parts. 245 laps complete. Kurt Busch the leader.
12 to the pit road.
Dale Jarrett racing Ricky Craven. Bobby Labonte goes past them with fresh tires.
And I tell you, Bobby Labonte's got a good race car. What he's trying to do is get as close to those leaders as he can. Remember, he's a lap down from having to come to pit road to pit for a flat tire. In the perfect world, the leader's pit, Darrell, you were talking earlier, and he gets a caution and gets his lap made up.
Yeah, he's got about 10 or so laps to play with. In that window, if he could get a caution, he'd be right back in this race. And he's definitely got a fast car, and 12 is in the pits.
DW, two stops ago, Ryan Newman's team, they changed the air pressures. His car went from loose to extremely loose. What they've done, they've gone back to the same pressure settings that Rusty Wallace has been running most of the race. They're hoping that corrects that very, very loose race car on the 12.
Robbie Gordon in the 31 car, he's on pit road.
And Terry Labonte as well. So green flag stops, the first set we've seen today. Robbie Gordon in. Now he had already gone a lap down. Jack Vann carrying our Fox crew cam around to the left side.
Boy, this is a neat shot. Josh Yost, their jack man. That happens in a hurry.
Jeff Burton is in, and so is Michael Waltrip. Burton had been racing for 19 with Jimmy Spencer and Kenny Schrader. Ricky Rudd was part of that battle.
Ricky had worked his way up into the top 15.
A little damage to the right rear on Rudd's car.
If you notice, the cars that's making the pit stops first, and as Jimmy Spencer in the 7 car comes to pit road as well, is cars that were running kind of back in the pack. Again, they're trying to get the advantage of those fresh tires before the leaders come to pit road.
Dick Berggren.
Rusty Wallace has just radioed to his crew that the car is getting much, much worse. He said he barely can hang on to it. Billy Wilbur and his crew chief said, you hang on to it. We need 10 more laps. We'll see if he can hang on that long, Mike.
Oh, boy, he's already slid to 8th place.
Yeah, and that was what I was saying earlier about Mark and Rusty. Rusty is going to be wanting to come to the pit earlier than Mark, but we'll see how it plays out.
Jack Sprague in the 0, Bill Elliott in the 9, Jeff Green all to pit road for 4 tires adjustments.
Larry Foyt, Kenny Wallace, who are not on the lead lap, both making stops. These are scheduled green flag stops.
This is when you don't really care how fast you're going right now. You're in that 10 lap window where you've got to stay out there for fuel mileage and thinking about the end of the race. You're racing, your numbers right now got to match up so you get to the end.
Greg Biffle is in as well. Biffle, the Busch Series champion, Winston Cup rookie.
Here comes Tony Stewart down pit road.
Kenny Schrader.
And this will greatly shuffle the field. You see that tape on Tony's left front fender.
Here comes
he ran
Mark.
To the back of Kyle Petty while trying to dodge a spinning Earnhardt Jr.
Here comes Mark.
Mark Martin, one of 5 drivers to lead this race, is on pit road.
And he's the first to come. Trust me, it won't be but 2 or 3 laps. The rest of those guys in the top 10, they'll be there with him.
Really surprised me. I thought he would stay out. His car was handling pretty good, but Matt, what's it looking like?
Well, DW, Mark Martin's coming in. Look for, you can see the wrench going in the back window. Mark Martin's car just not to his liking, and they kept telling him, new car's on the outside, new tires on the inside, new tires outside. So finally, they just decided to give up the ghost and come in and get some fresh tires. Meanwhile, Dale Jarrett, he's been making a run 6 times. He has finished 2nd or better here. His new crew chief, Brad Parrott, a number of wins as a car chief. Through the years, also part of Richard Petty's 200th win, looking for his first win at the crew chief, making an air pressure adjustment in the left rear of the 88. To Dick.
Rusty Wallace is on his way down pit road, and he's going to change the track bar, put around a wedge and an air pressure, then throw a whole bunch of stuff at this car to try and tighten it up. 38, Elliott Sadler also in. Kurt Busch is on his way in.
Dave Blaney was in, Johnny Benson, Steve Park, Jerry Nadeau, and the leader, Kurt Busch. Now on pit road, along with Ricky Craven and Jamie McMurray, all on pit road. Dick?
Both sides of the back end of that car trying to tighten it up. Wallace had led the majority of this event until it just went away. Matt.
Over the past 6 races, Kurt Busch, the most productive driver dating back to last year, No adjustments on this cop is Scott Radel. Ready to drop that jack to Steve.
Matt Kenseth, he's got a new front tire changer this year. Matt, Justin Nonestead on the front tires. They'll make a slight air pressure adjustment, quarter pound out of the right rear. The 17 car was almost as fast as the leaders late in that run. Four tires for Matt Kenseth.
Kenseth had picked up the lead and led two laps. This should put Sterling Marlin in front.
And Bobby Labonte in the 18 car, he came on the pit road. He went ahead and decided, hey, my car's good. I'm going to stay in sync with these guys. There you see him getting four fresh tires. Jimmy Johnson in the 48 car, he's the pit road.
Something not right there, because Johnson came around turn four on the apron. He didn't sweep down off the banking like the other cars have been doing.
I think it was traffic. I think he had some people right behind him, Mike. It looked like he was needing to get down out of their way. And the thing about Labonte, he drove up a half a lap on these cats. So if his car's that good, he wants to stay with them. Right now, he's right there with Kurt Busch.
And Sterling Marlin has not yet pitted.
And I mean, right now, he's given up 2 seconds a lap, because what happens, he can't maneuver his race car. These cars are catching him with those fresh tires. You can't get out of the way fast enough.
Don't you think, though, Larry, that maybe they're trying to do that fuel thing, get in a window where they can make it on one more stop?
But I tell you, Darrell, you know that just almost, I mean, just look at Dale Jarrett drive away from him. I think we're going to see him on pit road right there. There it is. He's passed his window, and he knows it, because he's on pit road now for four tires.
Steve Burns waiting on Sterling.
On the last stop, they had handling problems. They're one of the best cars early in the race, but they took two rounds of wedge out and changed air pressure on the left side. This time, they think they finally have the car the way they want it. They'll make a chassis adjustment to the right rear. A Sterling's number 40. They take a tearaway off the windshield. Jerry Schweitz pumps the gas in for the number 40 of Sterling Marlin. Service is done, and Sterling is headed down pit road.
And now we'll find out who made the right adjustment and who's quick after stops.
It's all said and done. Kurt Busch in the 97 car, he's back in the lead, but the real winner on this is Dale Jarrett in the 88. And the reason he's moved up to second, he was one of the first of the leaders to pit, got advantage of those fresh tires earlier.
So Kurt Busch reassumes the lead at lap 261 of the Subway 400 on Fox. Kurt Busch, the leader. Bobby Labonte is right behind him, trying to get one of his get his lap back and get back on the lead lap. And he's been about a tenth of a second quicker than Kurt Busch each of the last five laps, as you watch our aerial coverage furnished by Budweiser. Want to say hi to Fox NASCAR on Fox stage manager Lynn Jeffers, having a little minor surgery, and hope you're back with us soon. Up here in the booth, Kurt Busch leads Dale Jarrett by 2.6 seconds. Four Fords in the front four spots. There's Busch, your leader. Then it's Jarrett, Martin, Kenseth, and the Pontiac of Ricky Craven.
This joint is just, for some odd reason, always been a good Ford racetrack. We've always seen the tire band, the gear they can pull. Sun sets in the west, this track goes through another change, because the first and second turn become shadowed by the grandstand, and the sun beams down in the third and fourth turn, and you may have to adjust your car and your driving line to take advantage of that, or to compensate for it, I should say.
There's Bobby Labonte, that green Chevrolet, who is trying to get that lap back from Kurt Busch. Dick?
Yes, just heard from his crew chief, Pat Mac McSwain, who told him, you get by that 97. We're here to hunt. I've been working in that 18 pit most of the day, Mike, and I'll tell you what, those guys will all believe that they have a car that is capable of winning. Earlier, they had a punctured tire, which cost them a lap. They are trying to get that lap back now. They believe if they can, they could wind up this day in victory lane.
I mean, based on how he ran at the beginning of this race, yeah, if they can get that lap back, I think he can be if they're contending with these guys.
Kurt Busch is not the fastest car on the track right now. That last lap, Mark Martin was. And this lap, Matt Kenseth is. Jimmy Johnson, who has picked up a spot from 16th to 50th, also running quite quickly. And here is Kenseth, who has pulled up on his Roush stablemate Mark Martin, and the defending champion of this race is going to take over third.
And he's right down on that white line where he won this race a year
ago. Turn two, Jeremy Mayfield. A lot of smoke, a lot of fluid. Dale Jr. also.
Dale Jr. 19. Caution is out. Al, will Bobby Labonte get his lap back? Did they already take the flag?
There he comes. Here he comes.
Joe Nemechek's going to get his back. Casey Mears is going to get his back. Bobby Labonte gets his lap back. Tony Raines gets one back.
Matt?
Trouble on the 97, a flat right front. That's why you saw him slow down considerably and start to go to the high side.
Well, if you're going to have a flat, when somebody else brings out the caution, boy, that's the time to have it.
It's kind of like living a charmed life. Yeah, you can see it. It's flat over on the right side.
The caution.
Four, I could do have a right front flat.
That's Kurt Busch. There is Junior on the inside, and for the second time today, round he goes.
Same place.
Comes back up in the racetrack. Benson gets by, and poor old Jeremy. He got spun out earlier because somebody spun in front of him. Got hit by the 43 car, and I believe he just got it again. Same place, just around she goes.
Let's watch it from Johnny Benson's on board.
Pit Road was closed because of this right here. Here's Jeremy Mayfield, a 19 car. He's right there at the entrance of Pit Road.
Let's see what happened to him.
More than likely, he got nailed from the back again.
That's a bumper cam real time. And here's what happened.
There he comes. He sees the car up in front of him. Smoking. Bam. Head outside. Whoa, all right.
He have help?
I say that 99 car may have assisted him.
Mayfield to the garage and pit stops.
Yeah, pit road is still closed though because that tow truck is still there at the entrance of pit road, but it should be open next time by. The tow truck was there pushing Jeremy Mayfield.
With difficulty, Todd Bodine bringing out a caution to dump for the day. Another rookie, Jack Sprague, spinning Kenny Wallace here, Jeff Hammond.
Yeah, so that unexcusable right there. When you're a rookie, you got to be patient, not be getting in a hurry this early in the race. And there you see Jerry Nadeau also getting a little bit of help. Little lead going around. Here comes Jeremy Mayfield, who got hit in the back end by John Andretti.
Right, just moments ago, and this is not the replay of what you just saw. It's Earnhardt Jr. having problems, and in the back part of that, causing problems for Tony Stewart. In the meantime, Rusty Wallace, five-time winner of this race, leading for 182 laps, but on lap 220, Kurt Busch taking over, passing Rusty for the lead, and Kurt still has the lead.
Yes, he does. And right now, the handle basically gone away on the two car, and I think pit stops are getting ready to start after this series of caution flags. Jeannie?
Well, guys, we talked so much about crew chiefs being cheerleaders and coaches to get their drivers into shape. Jeff Gordon told his crew before the stop, hey, great stops all day. Let's keep it up. But I want a half round more off that right rear and drop that right rear tire pressure. Steve?
No adjustments on the 17 of Matt Kenseth, the genie. Crew chief Robbie Reiser saying, nice and easy, boys. Let's go to Matt.
And an extra pump and a half on the right side by Scott Radel, the jackman for Bush, because of that flat right front tire. Service complete. Hitting Bergeron.
Ricky Craven takes a round in the right rear. He says he feels that the left front isn't gripping well enough. He hopes that's going to get it to grip better. Kurt Busch puts him off Pete Rose.
Ricky Craven's crew gave him a good pit stop. He went from fifth to third on that sequence of stops. Much easier to pass him on pit road than on that racetrack.
And that's a much improved race team over a year or so ago.
And one errant tire rolling out there.
Looked like it come off of Elliott Sadler's, the 38 car. It'll be a penalty if anybody claims it.
Nobody's
you number.
Tires.
It's not my tire.
Yeah, look at it.
Now, you know they have to paint the car number on the rim.
This is true. Well, somebody borrowed my tire and wheel.
Oh, that's it.
I told him that's how much it weighed.
Yeah, that many pounds.
Not mine.
that was definitely the longest green run we had, right at 100 laps.
So caution is out for the sixth time today. The Subway 400 on Fox. The Subway 400 on Fox is brought to you by Budweiser. The best things in life are the things that are true. Budweiser. ...281 laps complete. We're coming off the sixth caution of the day. Everybody has made pit stops. And as soon as the track is clear, we'll be set for green flag racing. Let's go back to the Hollywood Hotel.
Well, Kurt Busch, who finished second in the Daytona 500, leading here. Let's go back to some of the pit stops and run through those quick. And the crew cam, right, which keeps an eye on things. Jeff, and you were part of a crew, aside from being a crew chief, a jackman.
I was a jackman for many years. And let's take a look and kind of like see what goes on during a pit stop. Because I feel like a jackman, as you can see right there, he's got to clear the car as the car's coming in. He's got to hit that jack stop. And then all of a sudden, he pries it down, one pump, gets it up, goes back, pulls the left rear tire off, helps the left rear tire guy, pulls it around, and he sits it out front so the other right front tire carrier can carry it away. Grab the jack, and around he goes. That jack weighs about 40 pounds. This barely clears the right front tire changer. Got to get there tight, safe steps. Again, one stroke, up comes the left side, about a stroke and a half there, a little bit behind. Again, catches that right front, the left front as it comes off. But look at him, he looks front, he looks at the back, makes sure everybody's hitting the nuts down, and away he goes. And what he has to do is make sure everything is done right, because he begins a pit stop, and to me, he ends a pit stop. And a lot of responsibility.
And certainly, let's go through now in the real time, right? And you'll see how happens, how quickly everything happens here, and how there is very little margin for error.
Car comes in there, like I said, about 45 miles an hour. All this is happening here in a matter of seconds, folks. If you have a good right side stop, you want to get down and around in about 7 seconds flat. Again, left side up, tire comes off. He's got to look front, look back, down and away he goes.
It's tough to get the full service like that anymore at your neighborhood station. Let's check in with Steve Burns. Steve?
Chris, with Robbie Reiser, crew chief for Matt Kenseth. Robbie, you guys have been adjusting. That time, no adjustments. He must like the car.
We got the car pretty good in the long run. You know, it's just need this thing to go green to the end. I think we got a shot at it. But, you know, the wall port's been running good, and the guys have done a great job over the wall today for a brand new group. And pretty excited with the way that this race is going.
Best of luck, Robbie.
Thanks.
Okay, thanks. UPS delivering a chance to win four tickets to the 2004 Daytona 500 by logging on to foxsports.com. UPS delivers. Dale Earnhardt Jr. had such a great speed weeks, but wound up 36th at the Daytona 500. He's had a rough go of things so far today, currently running 35th, and the DEI cars at the back of the pack. Kurt Busch, your leader. We're under our sixth caution at the Subway 400. Next weekend, the scene will shift to Las Vegas for another full weekend of racing. Friday, the Busch Series qualifying on speed, followed by Winston Cup qualifying at Fox Sports Net. Saturday, NASCAR Busch Series racing presented by KFC on FX, followed by Winston Cup practice. And then Sunday, start your day with NASCAR This Morning on Fox Sports Net, followed by the world's best drivers going bumper to bumper for NASCAR Winston Cup Series racing as NASCAR returns on the Fox Network from Las Vegas, hometown of Kurt Busch, who is our current leader in the Subway 400, followed by Mark Martin, Ricky Craven, and Dale Jarrett, the 88 car currently running fourth. Let's listen in.
How's your car on cold tires, low air pressures?
Pretty free on cold tires.
Yeah, you know, I'm feeling like it's got a little push to it. You know, I know what you're telling me, but based off air pressures, I feel like it's got a little push, and when you get back in the gas, there's your looseness.
No, I ain't feeling that.
10-4. I'm just going off the air pressures. I understand what you're telling me. 10-4. Well, look at the top, taking some air out of that front.
Team communications there with Dale Jarrett and his crew. Why don't you, in layman's terms, break that down for us, Joe?
Well, what's going on right there? Brad Parrott is looking at tire pressures and tire temperatures. They're telling him one thing, but his driver is relating something totally different. So they're trying to make sure they're talking about what the car is truly doing. And Brad was kind of like doing a little cross-examination right there, saying, are you sure it's not this? And Dale Jarrett has come back and said, nope, this is what the car is doing, and he's going to adjust accordingly.
All right, and Jarrett has won here at Rockingham before. Let's check in with Matt Yocum.
And Brad Perry, you told Dale Jarrett that probably if we go green from here, you'll have to stop with about 30 to go. What do you have left to do to the race car to make it a winning race car? You've been adjusting on the thing all day.
Yeah, we're going to keep adjusting until Dale drives that big brown truck for UPS, I think. No, the car's been great today. You know, we worked on it all day with no practice yesterday. Dale's drove his heart out, and he's the best driver here at Rockingham. We're going to make one more adjustment, and because we got to make one more stop. We don't give up, and we're not going to give up till we're in victory lane.
Now, if you may recall, 1 year ago in NASCAR Busch Series action, next week at Las Vegas will mark the anniversary of Brad Parrott scoring his first win as a crew chief. Second generation crew chief, his father, the legendary Buddy Parrott, following in some big footsteps. Hopefully today he goes all the way to victory lane.
All right, and former Winston Cup points champion Bobby Labonte, who also has won at the Rockingham moments ago. Jeff Hammond making his pit stop.
Well, I think right now what these guys are looking to do, they're topping the car off, trying to get all they can to clean the grill so they can stretch the fuel mileage as long as they can. His car's been really good all day long. I think they're trying to put a little bit of strategy in here. Back to Spain, maybe thinking two tires and about a can of gas to make the distance.
Okay, meanwhile, he's currently running 25th back in the pack. Now let's go to the 38 car, Elliott Sadler. We saw the tire bouncing around earlier, and so there is a penalty that NASCAR, once they identify whose tire that is, and I guess the car number is written on inside the tire rim?
Yeah, most of them are, and as you can tell right there it came out in middle pit road. And that's the reason why you've got to maintain control of these tires. Dale Jarrett hits that tire. He could have knocked it back into somebody, so he'll be called to pit road or have to restart at the very tail end of the longest line. So, you know, it's one of those things you can't do. And you see Bobby Labonte coming back down on pit road to get some more gas in his
car. How could he have, with fuel prices today, my goodness, he's going to have to take out a loan doing all this.
If he wins the race, he'll be able to cover it.
It'll be worth it all. Let's bring in a former crew chief or former ex-crew chief with Jeff Hammond, Larry McReynolds. Larry?
Yeah, I mean, again, guys, these things, this race is known for long green runs at the end, and this puts him, I think, in that window with 104 laps to go. He's banking up going green, but he didn't give up a whole lot. He only gave up about two or three positions to go in and get a full tank of fuel.
And I think, Larry, again, what they're trying to do is maybe get themselves in a position of two tires and one can of gas toward the end. So a little bit of strategy starting to play out here at Rockingham.
Let's go back up to Mike Joy, Darrell Waltrip, and Larry Mack.
And folks at home, y'all might be wondering what's going on right now. This is our seventh inning stretch right here.
Here's where the Coca-Cola Racing family is running. Kurt Busch the leader, Dale Jarrett fourth, Ricky Rudd 10th. And Chris, if you get sticker shock while filling up that German hot rod out in California at the pump, this 110 octane 76 racing fuel is but $4.95 a gallon retail.
And Tony Stewart, Bobby Labonte's teammate, elected to do the same thing as they got the one to go. He came in and topped off. Elliott Sadler, the real loser on this whole deal, came out seventh because you saw that tire roll across pit road. Equipment leaving the pit box has to go the tail end of the longest line, so he'll restart this race with about 100 laps to go in 27th.
We're set for the restart, folks. We're going to crank it up for you.
There, bud. Green flag, green flag.
Pit road, Larry, he was on the double up restart. He passed cars on the wrong side and advanced his position after they passed the white line over in the third turn, and NASCAR brought him in for that violation.
You know, you would just call that maybe a rookie error, but it's a stop and go penalty, but he's going to go at least another lap down. He was already one lap down, so now he'll be two laps down.
Kurt Busch has taken off to a 1 second lead over Mark Martin. Ricky Craven now third, Dale Jarrett, Matt Kenseth and Rusty Wallace have battled since they dropped the green flag here for fifth place. Now settled out in that order with Dave Blaney and Jeff Gordon moving in on Wallace.
You know, a guy that started 36th, and he's just been progressively working his way forward. Jimmy Spencer in that 7 car. He's up to 13th place right now. But you know, his crew chief, Tommy Baldwin, he's always had a pretty good package for this place. Worked with Ward Burton for a number of years.
Yeah, who let the dogs out? That's what Spence is doing. He's letting the dog out right now.
Jimmy Spencer is driving like a man that wants to show people he can drive a race car.
Yes, he does. And he got a good team there with Tommy Baldwin and the crowd. They could surprise some people.
Greg Biffle working the outside on Mike Skinner. There's that 16, the rookie, trying to thread the needle. Show you where the rookies are in this race.
Oh, Gordon goes around.
He and Dale Jr. may have made contact, and Gordon's going to save it and keep it out of oncoming traffic. Jerry Nadeau also spins.
Caution is out.
Seventh yellow of the day at lap 298.
Joe Nemechek trying to come and get his lap back, but it's not going to work.
Boy, Jerry Nadeau doesn't want to pull out in front of all these guys coming here.
And Nadeau will not be able to stay on the lead lap.
Go real far.
Let's see what happened to Jeff Gordon.
Got in the back of Dale Earnhardt Jr., the 8 car. Dale Earnhardt Jr. didn't get in trouble.
I can tell you what that's all about. Dale Jr., a couple laps down, he passed Gordon going into 3 over there and slid up in front of him. And I don't know what happened after that. You'd have to ask them.
And we've been 7 laps since we pitted. Looks like most of the leaders are going to come to pit road, but this definitely puts them all in the window. They could go to the distance to the end. All the lead lap cars to pit road. Except Bobby Labonte in the 18 car. He stayed out.
Steve?
Robbie Reiser decided to go ahead and put 4 tires on. Russ Strupp is the jack man. Benji Grubb the gas man. Let's go to Matt Yoakum.
Now Kurt Busch says his car is just a little bit tight. They're going to make an air pressure adjustment in the left rear. Meanwhile, Mark Martin says no adjustments on the 6. Service complete for Busch. Dick?
Ricky Craven is in. He is also going to take 4 tires. They're not even sure if they're in their window in terms of being able to go all the way on fuel. Craven now out.
Craven's team and Ty team's doing a great job today, Larry. I mean, they're getting him in and out there with everybody, keeping him right up front.
They have done a good job. You know, those guys really started to turn the curve last year with their pit stops. So of all the lead lap cars, everybody pitted for 4 tires except for Bobby Labonte, an 18 car right there.
Well, you know, we saw him come in and out there just before they went back to green, and so he's happy with the car and the gas mileage. Jeannie?
Right front fender damage, guys, for the 24 of Jeff Gordon. Actually, it wasn't as bad as they thought it would be. They were ready with some tape, but basically Gordon came in and said, give me the 4 tires and just get that fender cleared, and that is exactly what they did. Remain hopeful here in the 24 pit.
We need to document that Dave Blaney, our pole sitter, and Jeff Burton, they stayed out as well. Here's the crew cam on Robbie Gordon again, the 31 car. Josh Yost, Fox Sports crew cam.
You can see him looking, Larry. You see him look front, look rear, look front, look rear.
Because he knows that car can't leave until all those lug nuts are tight and it's on his shoulders, because Robbie Gordon's job is to leave when that car hits the ground.
Show you from Michael Walters, Napa onboard camera. There's Jerry Nadeau just ahead.
Oops. Run into it from behind. You know, either one spotter did a really, really good job, or the other spotter did a really, really bad job. I'm not sure which.
But Nadeau ends up a lap down because he could not get refired before the leaders came around.
We're hearing that Robbie Gordon in the 31 car, he's going to come back to pit road because he's missing 1 lug nut. You have to have 20 lug nuts on that car before you leave pit road.
4,500, here we come, guys.
Dick Bergeron with the crew chief of our pole sitter.
That's Booty Barker. What is your strategy from here, especially out of fuel?
I don't know yet. I guarantee you, you'll have another caution. You're not going to go all the way here on, on a green flag run.
A big run today. Are you surprised at how well this team is doing today?
No. What I expected.
There you go. Rookie crew chief, he expected to run up front. Good boy, Booty.
Good answer.
I love that.
Dave Blaney started on pole, and he's now the second place car.
But you know, Darrell, with only 7 or 8 laps on their tires, I know that's a lot, but I like the strategy of Bobby Labonte, Dave Blaney, and Jeff Burton, because you know, 4 tires back there at 25th, that's you're going to use them up before you can even get up to about 10.
That's what you say, UGLY. Right, ugly.
Going to be 91 laps to go as they take this restart. Bobby Labonte is the new race leader.
And not long ago, he was a lap and a half down.
Had that flat tire under green. There you see the Fox tracks through 1 and 2, building the speed up from 55 miles an hour up to 130 miles an hour off turn 2.
Yeah, he's a little, didn't really get off of turn 2 all that well. Probably had a little debris on his tires.
He's up there trying to keep these cars a lap down. Casey Mears in the 41. Looked like Dave Blaney, Jeff Burton challenging for the lead in the 99 car.
Boy, and Blaney's right there too. I mean, we got a gaggle going down in turn 1 here.
We haven't seen Burton all day, and suddenly he is a factor for the lead.
Nemechek in the 25 and Casey Mears in the 41. They are on the tail end of the lead lap, and they'd be back in the lead lap if they catch a caution.
I just think Mike has showed you how critical track position is. The 99 car's been back in the field all day. They hadn't said much about him. Here he is up the front, and obviously he's got a car good enough to stay there.
He had to start back in 38.
Jeff Burton has just become the 10th different leader of this race. Jeannie?
Well, we are not in Las Vegas yet, guys, but that doesn't mean you can't be gambling down here in the pits. J.B. McMurray's crew chief, Donnie Wingo, has decided and told his driver, hey, if it goes green from here, we're going to gamble. He said that with 92 laps to go. Keep in mind, guys, it was just a few laps ago on the radio when McMurray stepped in and said, how far can we go on a tank of gas? And they said 88. You do the math, guys. It's going to be fun.
Jeff, you got your calculator working?
Dude, right now, Mike, I was looking and watching Jeff Burton. You've been talking about him. He just ran the fastest lap of his race today on lap 304. So, I mean, it goes to show you being back there in traffic can slow you down quite a bit.
And I kind of like what Booty Barker said. I don't think we've seen the last of the caution flags. I believe the yellow rag will be out again.
There you see the fastest guy. That lap right there was Kurt Busch in that 97 car. Not surprising.
Less than 100 laps to go, 7 caution flags so far, mostly for spins off of turn 2. But turn 4 has had its share of action.
But Darrell, Bobby Labonte in 18, he is running a strange line. He goes in low into turn 3, and then he lets it go all the way against the wall almost in the middle of 3 and 4.
Car must be real tight. You know, maybe she's running up the hill with him.
And he's right around the bottom in 1 and 2, which is what we've been seeing a lot.
Yeah, well, this turn, if you look at 1 and 2, it's become shaded now. Going to pick up a little grip in 1 and 2. Going to lose a little grip in 3 and 4.
28 cars on the lead lap, including Nemechek and Mears, who are on the tail end of the lead lap. It's still anybody's race.
There you see the battle right there. That's for 6. Dale Jarrett in 88, Mark Martin in 6, Rusty Wallace in the 2 car. They've worked on trying to get that car tightened up, and Jamie McMurray right with them.
Yeah, I think these cautions, these last couple, have helped Rusty because I think he was off a little bit. Now he looks like he's got his setup working again.
Kurt Busch pulls up on the tail end of his teammate, and Jeff Burton in the 99, he knows Kurt Busch is quicker. He used a hand signal. Pass me on the inside to turn 1. That's smart racing.
Well, Kurt Busch stopped and got tires, 99. He didn't, and so he's all just those few laps are going to make a difference.
Because they sit there and race each other, they're just going to use each other's tires up.
And here comes Labonte up alongside Burton a long way around.
Dave Blaney back there, he's still holding on to 4th, but Ricky Craven's all over the back of him in the 32 car. Looks like Bobby Labonte's car, I think you were right. When they restarted this race, Darrell, because he hadn't pitted, he had a lot of junk on his tires and didn't get them cleaned off good.
Larry, one other thing here about Rockingham we don't need to forget is the longer you run, the more rubber you get on a racetrack, the easier it is on tires, even though you still drop off some, but you don't tear them up or wear them out quite as fast.
Definitely. The longer you go, you'll see these guys run longer, and I think that's the reason a lot of them had said, hey, if this thing stays green, we can go the distance without pitting for fuel or tires.
I tell you, McMurray is wearing Rusty out. He's all over him.
Boy, talking about wearing somebody out, Mark Martin in that six, boy, he drove all over the back of Dale Jarrett in 88 car coming off turn four that time.
Well, it was like a slide job, Larry. He went way low in turn three and carried the low groove all the way around.
Well, he's getting caught up from behind with Rusty, and those two cars running side by side. He's faster, but he can't get by.
Riding with Dale Jarrett.
See, right there in the middle of the corner, I mean, Mark just accelerates so hard, but when he comes off the corner, nowhere to go.
And he's much faster than Dale Jarrett, I think, right now.
Well, if we go caution-free, this strategy will probably bite eight of the top 10 drivers right now.
Very well could.
Casey Mears trying to hold off and stay on the lead lap, hold off Kurt Busch.
I mean, we've talked about tires all day. Anytime you got a chance to put tires on here, you better take it. Boy, Mark is up on the wheel right now, guys.
Speaking up on the wheel, how about Bobby Labonte? Of course, contributed to Casey Mears in the 41. He's doing what he's supposed to, but it's allowed Bobby Labonte to close right up on Kurt Busch in the 97.
That's six and the 88 and the two back here, boys. Veterans, and you got a rookie in there hounding them all. It's incredible.
Two great battles. We'll show them both to you.
Oh, man, you got to show them that.
Lead battle on the left. Fourth place, fifth place battle on the right.
Y'all take the one on left. I'll take the one on the right.
And I mean, just again, Jamie McMurray, we keep talking about him, but he's up there racing with a lot of years of experience, and he's a rookie.
And you know, he's such a nice kid. It's like, you know, y'all come on up here and race with this kid. We like you.
Amazing what those five or six races in that 40 car, I think, did for his confidence, plus the confidence of the competitors to race with him.
Exactly. Sterling's off the pace here, guys. I don't know what's wrong with him. He's just up high out of the groove.
And with only three cars out of the race so far, Mayfield, Todd Bodine, and Derek Cope, that will really be a blow to Sterling's chances. Let's go to the pits.
Mike Sterling has reported he has a miss in the motor. He's reporting a miss to Lee McCall and Tony Glover.
You see right there just how much he's off the leader. And we'll watch his Fox tracks right here, 106 miles an hour. He's about 20 miles an hour off what he should be running off the corner, and it's getting slower the whole time.
And Darrell, we talk about title hopes. It's never too early to start talking.
Me and Hammond were just talking this morning. They turned these motors 9200 down here. Show them what he broke, Jeff.
Yeah, Darrell, sitting right here, I've got a valve spring and a rocker arm in my hand. Today, when going through the garage, a lot of guys were telling me they were really concerned about the RPMs and whether the valve springs or this rocker arm would be able to withstand it. You brought out a point early on about these Dodges turning 92 to 9300 RPM. It could be catching up with them now.
Yeah, I mean, right now, he's almost 9 seconds off the pace. There's a minimum speed, and they have thrown the black flag because he can't run the minimum speed that they're required cars to run.
Ricky Craven's just taken over third place. He's just moved ahead of Jeff Burton and into third. Steve Burns.
Mike Sterling Marlin just reported the water temperature is over 250 degrees, and he said it blew up.
He's coming to pit road now. He's on the apron in turn four.
And what happens, Mike, is you break a valve spring, and the engine skips a little bit. And then the next thing you know, the valve floats down and the piston hits it. It'll break the valve off, it'll stick it through the piston, and it'll cause the engine to blow up and get hot.
But I tell you, that's something we've not seen very much with that 40 car over the last couple of years, is blown engine.
Battle for ninth, Rusty Wallace, Matt Kenseth, and the eighth place car just ahead, 77 of Dave Blaney. Put Ward Burton in the picture as well. This battle for eighth place now.
Yeah, and the guy that's really, I mean, just falling off the pace is that two car. I mean, here he was, led the whole race. Looked like he had the car to beat. And look that way now.
Clear high, inside only.
That's called, it's when you say, excuse me.
Here's a battle for the lead again. Bobby Labonte, remember, he has seven more laps on his tires than Kurt Busch, but he has not given up on Kurt Busch.
Yeah, but the way Bobby drives and the way Kurt drives, Kurt's tires might think they got more laps on them than they do.
Bobby Labonte running that high groove.
Now they have passed Casey Mears, who was on the tail end of the lead lap, as they battle for the lead at 323 laps. 70 to go as Subway 400 on Fox. The Subway 400 on Fox is brought to you by Subway, where racing fans go for delicious, fresh-made sandwiches. Subway, eat fresh. By the Home Depot, NASCAR's home improvement warehouse. By Coca-Cola, the official soft drink of NASCAR. And by Ford. If you haven't looked at Ford lately, look again. 330 laps complete. Ford, Chevy, Pontiac, and three Fords. The first Dodge in the race, though, is the one that's catching that pack. Jamie McMurray in seventh has come right up to the back bumper of Jeff Burton, but can get no further.
And right there,
it's almost like Kurt Busch is just not getting off the corner as good as maybe it was earlier.
I think he just really has driven the wheels off his car. How about it, Dick?
Well, I'm going to ask Pat back this, Wayne. Have you guys got enough gas for Bobby Labonte to go all the way?
Well, you want the real answer?
Yeah, I
want the real answer. Or you want the TV answer? The real answer is, I ain't got a clue. We're really, really close right now. We're still punching numbers and crunching numbers. But we'd take a caution if it came out, too.
All right, good luck with it.
I appreciate an honest man.
Well, and you don't really know, because the driver drives a little harder and the thing burns a little more fuel. And one thing about it, Kurt Busch isn't going to make it easy for him.
And right now, Bobby Labonte's not conserving any fuel either. He's doing everything he can to get the lead of this race.
Meanwhile, Jamie McMurray has climbed to sixth, right behind Martin.
You know, it's such an exciting feeling to be down in a pit and for the driver on the track to make up laps and to get yourself where you was out of contention. Now you're back in contention up there fighting for the lead. That does so much for your team.
And as we watch the leaders battle and Kurt Busch get a little loose, you see Dale Jarrett top of the screen. He has moved past Ricky Craven into third.
The way these guys are driving, Larry, I mean, it indicates to me they think they can't make it and they're going to have to stop again.
There's probably some that's going to be borderline in making it. Right here, looking out of Dale Jarrett's, that's where it gets tough, getting into turn one. If you look at the fuel tanks, notice Kurt Busch has a little more than Bobby Labonte. Dale Jarrett, he's about like Kurt Busch. These two guys right here, we feel like they probably can make it, but Bobby Labonte's going to be the one that's a little borderline.
Well, he came in and topped off there under that one caution a number of times.
And folks, our fuel data is extrapolated based on what these cars have done so far today. We do not have an actual fuel gauge in this car. In these cars, but if we did, it would look just like that.
We were making an educated guess.
Now, I've got to know about that word you used.
Extrapolated or fuel gauge?
Extrapolated. Extrapolated.
Matt Kenseth just went by his teammate, Jeff Burton, in the 99 car. That's for eighth position, Steve Burton.
Larry Mack, they feel like here in the 17th pits, they can make it to the end on gas if they need to, but Matt Kenseth is a little concerned that he's used up too much of his tires since that last restart. Jeannie Zelasco.
Well, it's been truly a pleasure listening to Jamie McMurray on the radio, looking at this track through somewhat fresh eyes. He says right now he has a great car and that he can really haul through turns one and two, turns three and four. He says, I'm a joke, but I'm having fun. Matt?
Well, Jeannie, DW's gas gauge is pretty accurate as far as Kurt Busch's team is concerned. They feel like they are good to go the distance on fuel.
And you know, these guys really only have one good check on what they're using for fuel. Fuel mileage, that's that long green run. The pace slows down so much that you're using less fuel than if you just checked it on a 20 lap run.
Yeah, I like it when it gets like this. Who can make it and who can't?
You've taught me never to say you can't make it.
Oh, yeah. You can't say that because these guys are always holding something.
Back to Dale Jarrett, who runs in third, and he scooted away from Ricky Craven by about half a second. And there's Craven. Five of Ricky Craven's top 14 career finishes have been right here at The Rock, including a pair of thirds here in 1996 and '97. Mark Martin They've called this Markingham 2 Cup and 9 Busch Series wins, but he's 3.8 seconds off the lead right now.
And falling back. I don't know what's happened to Mark. He's running right around the bottom, but here comes McMurray up on him. And Markiston, it's almost like Mark is trying to save fuel, because he doesn't look like his car's handling bad. He just looks like he's pushing it real hard right now.
Jamie McMurray has caught Mark, and then Rusty Wallace, who was so strong in the early stages of this race, now just about 6 seconds off the lead with Matt Kenseth. That's 7th and 8th place. Jeff Burton is another 1.5 seconds back. And the Burton brothers, Jeff and Ward, running together, 9th and 10th, and Dave Blaney, 11th, right with them.
But I tell you, this Roush organization, they picked up right where they left off last year. All 4 cars right now, Kurt Busch, Mark Martin, Matt Kenseth, and Jeff Burton in the top 9.
Yeah, and Ward Burton's having a pretty good day for himself, too, you know. He's been hanging around the top 10 all day. Our pole sitter, he's just working his way back into the top 10 here at the end of the day.
Yeah, Blaney's car, it's definitely showing up that it has a little older tires on than these guys right there. He's losing a little more ground.
50 laps to go next time by. Ricky Rudd has hung around the top dozen all day long in the Wood Brothers Ford.
And he's all but a Roush car. He has Roush engines and Roush chassis.
But he's got Leonard Wood over there tuning on it, too. And that's a big plus.
Next comes Ryan Newman and Mike Skinner, 13th and 14th.
Hey, Mike Skinner in the 4 car, he's been doing a good job just keeping out of trouble and been back there anywhere from 10th to 15th all day.
And back up front to Kurt Busch, 0.7 seconds ahead of Bobby Labonte. And Darrell, we're doing the same things the crew chief are doing. We're taking
49 years old, that's 41 on the tire.
We're taking 2 known pieces of data. How many gallons you used on that last run and how many laps you ran, and we're extrapolating the big number, which is how far can you go?
But one thing we need to take a look at too, earlier in the race they were running down in the 25, 80s and 90s. Now they've slowed down to where they're running a 26-40. So that means you're out of the throttle a lot longer than you were earlier in the day. That's going to improve gas mileage.
Tell you what, the car that seems to be really coming, he's definitely a little bit quicker right there with Kurt Busch and Bobby Labonte, but that's Odell Jarrett, that 88 car, the UPS car. And he's been good on the long runs. We heard him and his crew chief Brad Parrott talking about that earlier.
I drove that 88 car in 98 over in Japan, and Brad was the tire guy. Him and Todd were working on the car. Brad was the tire guy, and they could do more with tires than anybody I'd ever been around in my life. I mean, they'd look at the tire buildups and Brad would say, here's what I think the car's doing and here's what I think it needs, and he was righter than I was.
Well, their dad, Buddy Parrott, was a pretty good guy with tires.
Yeah, he was. I mean, Buddy and I used to go in the Goodyear truck and pick out the tires by codes when nobody else knew what the codes were. And eventually they had to stop us from doing that because everybody said, they're getting special tires.
Well, I tell you, I know it's a battle a little bit out of the top 10, but that battle back there for 11th with Dave Blaney, Ricky Rudd, Ryan Newman, Mike Skinner, these guys have been going at it hard, catching Jeff Burton in the 99, who's up in 10. And Ricky Rudd, he's a little bit like Mike Skinner. He's just been consistently working his way forward as we ride with him right here. There you see he's about almost a half lap down to our leader right now, about 11 seconds.
Ricky's one of those kind of guys, as you well know, Larry, that just kind of lets things come to him. As everybody else kind of cars go away and maybe they overdrive their cars, he just lets it come to him and he picks them off one at a time.
And even though this is an oval, a lot like a road course, you drive it with that throttle pedal as much as you do the steering wheel here, and that's something he really shines with.
Darrell, what's it do to you to come out of turn 4 into bright sunlight and glare and then go into turn 2 where the track is under heavy shade?
Well, there's a huge transition. As you head off into turn 1 right here, you really can't see. Even with the tear-offs on the windshield, you just kind of know where you want to be. You feel your way down in there. Then right in the middle of the corners, you get turned. Now you can see well because you're going away from the sun.
Let's see it with Dale Jarrett.
Now, the thing that makes it a little deceiving is these cars nowadays have the tear-offs, so they can keep the windshield a lot cleaner than what we used to be able to. But look at that. See how it glares? Sometimes you go down in that corner and you almost feel like you missed the corner because you can't see it coming.
Clear low.
And there's, I mean, so much would happen with those glass windshields we used to run. We run a plastic Lexan windshield now, It gets sandblasted. You couldn't see. You had all grease on it. And, I mean, I'd worked with a lot of drivers. He just said, hey, I'm going to follow the car in front of me getting into turn one. If he hits a wall, I'm probably going to hit it too.
Yeah, and you really relied on your spotter, which was usually right down in that end of the racetrack on the top of that building down there to get you down in the corner.
Teammates were side-by-side for sixth place. Matt Kenseth, who won this race 1 year ago, has just passed Mark Martin and moved up to sixth.
You know, if this becomes a fuel mileage issue, you know, you have to kind of tip your hat to the Roush cars. They normally get pretty good fuel mileage.
Comes a couple of cars on pit road, Harvick, Dale Jr.
See Kevin Harvick in the 29 along with Dale Earnhardt Jr. in eight car, they're on pit road.
I don't think that's for fuel. I think that's for just some relief.
No, Harvick came and topped off just before we went green the last time.
Yeah, he just says, put some tires on this thing. I'm tired of fighting with it.
This is Dale Earnhardt Jr. right here. And what I think they did, they took that last 100 laps and they just broke it in half and put four fresh tires on. Could pay off.
Might pay off. Yeah, might pay off.
What you do this point of the race, you start figuring out who you're racing.
Yep.
Not if you're back there not trying to win the race, you're just trying to figure out who you're racing. Dick Berman, how about Kurt Busch's strategy, though?
Well, I can tell you about how his car is going, at least based on what Bobby Labonte has told his crew. Labonte said that he himself is pushing the nose a bit when he picks up the throttle. And then he said Busch is also doing the same thing.
Here comes Jarrett underneath Bobby Labonte for second place.
And what they mean by that, Darrell, is when he picks the throttle up and picks the speed of the car up, the front wheels slide. It's not responding to the steering wheel turning.
Yeah, you're setting back on the rear springs and kind of lifting up the front wheels, and they just take off with you.
And the only way you can do it, slow the speed of the car down. The steering wheel don't fix it.
Got to let the car take a set.
Matt Kenseth continues his march toward the front. Here he comes into frame right there. He's right on the back bumper of Jamie McMurray. This would be for fifth place.
I just think, based on what I've seen so far, I just think there's a bunch of guys down there pretty nervous about their fuel.
Now, Matt Kenseth is almost 0.2 seconds faster than this man, Kurt Busch, the race leader. Speeds at the line. Kenseth takes over fifth. Let's go to the leader's pit and Matt.
Well, Mike, Bobby Labonte was right when he said the 97 car was tight, but it's tight in the center of the corner and loose up off. That's what Kurt Busch told his crew chief Jimmy Finnick back on lap 351. Right now, just riding until the finish. Jack Roush gave the thumbs up, good to go on fuel. Now let's just see if the kid can pull it off. He was third here last fall.
I just think his driving style and everything, he's a little harder on his car than some of the, maybe Dale Jarrett or even Mark Martin would be, or Bobby Labonte, because he just stays after it all the time.
Busch puts Greg Biffle a lap down. That leaves 23 cars on the lead lap. Matt?
Well, Mike, in DW, that's exactly what Chris Morris, the spotter for Mark Martin, and Ben Leslie were telling Mark. He says he's going to wear out his stuff. We just need to be patient, nice and smooth like you always are here, and we should be able to be up there to make a run at the win. They're telling him just to be patient. They feel like his young teammate is going to wear his stuff out.
Well, I agree with that, but I don't agree with the fact that Mark's awfully far back. He's lost a lot of ground to the lead pack.
7 seconds.
Yeah, so I don't like that.
One of the Roush cars, Greg Biffle in the 16, he came to pit road to get four tires and fuel.
He had just gotten lapped, Larry, and that's a good time to pull in. Once you get off that lead lap, go get tires.
I can watch Mark, and I can tell you, he is driving like he's on eggs or on ice. He's not hustling the car at all. And so I'm sure that's his strategy, to save something for a charge with about 20 to go.
You look at the Fox tracks right there, he's continuing to lose just a little bit. Just since we've had it up there, 7.4, now to 7.5. So he's definitely not gaining. I'm going to tell you who is gaining, Dale Jarrett, that 88 car. Kurt Busch is fixing to have his hands full.
Tell you who else is gaining is Matt Kenseth. He has caught Ricky Craven for fourth.
And right now, I think Matt Kenseth and Dale Jarrett definitely have the quickest race cars on the racetrack.
But do they have enough time? For Jarrett, yes. For Kenseth, we'll see.
We got 30 laps to go. 30 laps to get it done, 30 laps to make it, 30 laps to not make it.
And the fastest car on the racetrack the last two laps has been Kenseth. Now here's Jeff Burton battling our pole sitter, 77 Dave Blaney. This is for 11th place. Jimmy Johnson is part of that battle as well.
You know, to me, one of the most phenomenal things is Kurt Busch. I mean, all of a sudden, latter part of last year, the kid just started winning races. And then he starts this year off. He finishes second at Daytona. Here he is up front leading this race and a good shot of winning this one. I don't think there's any stopping this kid.
And you know, I talked to Jimmy Finney, his crew chief. They were definitely one of the teams that didn't want to see the 2002 season end. One of the biggest fear was the new body change. Jimmy was concerned, could they get it going as good as they had the old body? Looks like to me they've done it. They've accomplished it.
Yeah, and the Ford and the Dodge got such a minor change, Larry. I mean, they really just got the kick out on the nose. They just built it into the nose instead of adding it on like they were doing at the end of last year.
You saw Dave Blaney move past Jeff Burton. That's for 11th place. Ryan Newman is going to join that battle from 11th on back. Four cars now fighting for that spot.
Yeah, Jimmy Johnson in 48 went by Jeff Burton as well. And I talked to Chad Knaus about several things this morning, and they really were wanting to redeem themselves. This was a racetrack that fought them last year. They had a good run in the fall, had the loose wheel, and shook the hub loose. They had to go behind the wall for major repairs.
Johnson currently 12th. Jeff Burton falls into the clutches of Ryan Newman. And right behind them, Elliott Sadler, who had that penalty for the tire rolling out onto pit road, has climbed back up to 15th and continues to march forward.
Definitely, no matter what happens, Elliott Sadler has passed more race cars here today than anybody when you figure the repair on the nose and then having to go to the rear of the field for the wheel rolling out on pit road.
And as I mentioned earlier, Dale Jarrett is running the setup that Sadler and them came down here and developed on the test. Brad Parrott said, you know, Dale didn't run all that great here last time, so we're just going to throw that at it and see how he likes it and learn something. Learn if Dale Jarrett and Elliott Sadler can run the same setup. So I think they've learned a lot today.
Now Jimmy Spencer moving into view, battling with outside pole sitter Johnny Benson and Jeff Green. That would be 18th, 19th, and 20th. Looking back from Benson's Valvoline Pontiac.
Just saying, Mike, we used to run 500 miles here. The fall of 1995, they cut it 100 miles off of it back to 400 miles. So, but we used to run 500 miles here. You had to pack your lunch, buddy.
All clear.
Back up front, Dale Jarrett, who in a 5-year period from 1996 to 2000, had 6 second place finishes here and 1 win and no finishes worse than 7th.
That group always had this place figured out from the very beginning.
Got the 45 behind you on fresh tires.
And for so long here, you had to start up front. If you didn't start up front here, you weren't really considered a contender. Now they start, you know, 37, 38 and are factors in the race.
But I tell you, you heard Dale Jarrett's spotter tell him about Kyle Petty and the 45 or fresh tires. Of course, you see Kyle right there just drive by him. It's so important for that spotter. It's one of the most valuable jobs he plays here, Rosie plays here, is letting you know about a car coming with fresh tires because they will run over you.
And that's the thing you always tell the spotter. Tell me things I don't know. Don't tell me things that I know. Tell me things I can't see.
Yeah, two of the fastest cars on the track right now are Robbie Gordon and Kyle Petty because they've both just been in the pits. Kyle served a 15-second penalty for a tire that rolled out of his pit box. Larry Foyt making his last stop of the day. Only 4 cars in the garage. Marlon Mayfield, Todd Bodine, and Derek Cope.
Which is pretty typical Rockingham. You have a lot of cautions, you just don't end up with a lot of attrition. People fix their cars and come back out.
I think right now, if you're leading the race or up there in the first 2 or 3, you just don't want to beat yourself. Just drive a smart race and don't do anything to beat yourself.
Kyle Petty and Steve Park just got together in front of Kurt Busch. An anxious moment for the race leader.
Yeah, well, Kyle's got those new tires. You run up on somebody and you know, the guy's trying to get out of your way, and first thing you know, you run into him.
There's the leader lapping Jerry Nadeau.
The closing rate on new tires, the old tires, is almost 10 mile an hour. So you really run up on a guy in a hurry, and he doesn't know which way to go.
See what happened here.
Going off into turn 3. And I mean, right there in front of our leader. Kurt was going as high as he could, but he was about to run out of racetrack.
And Kyle couldn't go low. There was a car on the apron looking to pit.
A
we were saying the safest place on the track was way out in front. There is no safe place. Ward Burton, Ricky Rudd, Dave Blaney, and Elliott Sadler. Now they're all battling for 10th place.
And then you throw that 74 car up in the middle of the day. He's got fresh tires. Kind of muddies up the water when he gets up in there mixing it up with the guys that are racing each other.
Yeah, because he's seven laps down.
Yeah, but they'll just let him go on by on the bottom.
Elliott Sadler in that 38, he's getting everything he can get out of that piece right now as we have about 18 laps to go.
Well, he and little Raymond, Ray Fox the third there, they've done a good job today. They did their homework. They came and tested. They gave their teammate a good setup. They should be proud of what they've accomplished this weekend.
And the two drivers who dominated this race, Mark Martin is 12 seconds off the lead in seventh, and Rusty Wallace 15 seconds off the lead in eighth.
And I think in Mark's case, it's not a case of where they overadjusted. We heard our guys talking. They were not making a lot of adjustments, but I just think the racetrack went away from them. It changed.
Yeah, Mark is just really, really, I can't believe how slow he's going. He's just hugging the bottom. Looks like the car's really picked up a bad push.
15th place race. And look who Kurt Busch has caught. Jimmy Spencer moves aside, running in 19th position.
Oh boy, Kurt has to really work to get under him.
Trust me, he's going to have to work real hard. And you see Dale Jarrett, he's pulled right up there with him. And Greg Biffle behind him in the 16, he has fresh tires.
Here Dale waiting on him. Here the tires try to spin.
Clear high, car rear, behind you, don't press.
Try to get back in the gas, and you just can't. You can't get that rear grip.
There you see Biffle in the 16 with those fresh tires.
What drives you crazy here is the tires wear. You lose the front going in and you lose the rear coming off. And you just, it's so frustrating.
And it's, you know, it's aggravating. You know, it just drives you crazy. But these guys on fresh tires and you're out there sliding around and you can't run where you want to run.
Kurt Busch exercising patience. Meanwhile, at 10th place, Ricky Rudd, Ward Burton, and Elliott Sadler continue to battle.
I tell you, we've seen some great finishes here, guys. You know, cars coming down here, come off turn four, one high, one low. Saw Steve Park and Bobby Labonte have a whale of a finish here a couple of years ago.
Steve Burns.
Mike Matketz just radioed his pits and said, guys, be ready. I think I may have a flat tire. All of a sudden, guys in the pits here got very busy. He said, I may have a flat tire.
And then what happens is when the tires wear out, you think they're flat. I mean, they feel like they're flat because they lose all their grip.
And I just look at his last lap time. It don't look like he's off what the leader just ran.
Jeff Hammond.
You don't believe that our leader right now has been driving hard. Watch, he can go up here. Two laps ago, this is what he did coming off of four. He kisses the wall right there off of four. That's how hard he's up on the wheel right now and how loose that race car is getting.
Jeff, he knows there's only about 12 laps to go, 11 laps to go now. So he knows with DJ right in his rear view mirror, he's got to get all he can.
Right now, he wishes Dale Jarrett was driving the big brown truck. He might be able to get away from that.
Going to put a lap on Mike Skinner.
And Dale Jarrett right now, he's loving this. He knows this guy is really watching his rearview mirror and driving awful hard. He's putting a lot of pressure on him.
And they are in a gaggle of cars, a gaggle of lap cars. They're almost side by side, though, here with 10 laps to go.
And Dale's got the position going down into turn one.
Heavy traffic ahead. Jarrett has to put two wheels on the apron.
This could be ugly.
And look just ahead of him.
That was ugly.
Tons of traffic.
Touched it. Got Kurt Busch out of
Kurt's
shape.
Trying to squeeze in between Jarrett and Gordon.
Couldn't do it.
Jarrett would have no part of that. He used a 24 for a pick.
First time Dale Jarrett has led today.
18 car on pit road.
Be smooth. Take care of it.
Bobby Labonte pits for fuel.
That makes me wonder
who else is going to be short on fuel.
It's going to be mighty close.
Nine to go. Dick Bergman.
Bobby Labonte coming down pit road for fuel. They weren't too sure if he was going to make it or not. Bobby wanted tires, but his crew chief, Fatback McSwain, has just said, negative, I can't take the time. Jim Gilbert with the gas can. Quick, one, two, three, and he's out of here.
But look at the race traffic that Dale Jarrett has to contend with and a bumper full of Kurt Busch.
Boy, and Kurt Busch has turned his car every way but loose.
And all these guys are fighting to stay on the lead lap. They're doing what they have to do.
Kurt's getting a little annoyed. I think they're getting a little annoyed with Jeff Gordon up in there, but Jeff's just trying to stay on the lead lap. But now he's been lapped by Dale Jarrett. he needs to let Kurt Busch go on.
And look how far Dale Jarrett and 88 is driving away from Kurt Busch right now. But boy, Kurt got a good run off turn four down the front stretch. But right there, that seems like that's where Dale beats him so bad. Kurt's just not getting off the corner.
Yeah, he's loose. See him back, see the back end jump out.
Saying Matt Kenseth is coming, and Matt Kenseth is within a second of Kurt Busch.
He is coming in a hurry. It wasn't that long. He was about 3 or 4 seconds behind these guys.
He can't make it. He's got too much traffic. Everybody in front of him just had to move out of his way, and that ain't going to happen.
Five laps to go. Next time by for Dale Jarrett, trying to notch his second Rockingham victory. He has a ton of top fives here.
More traffic. You got two cars running side by side here, the 99 and the 10.
And one of them is Kurt Busch and Matt Kenseth's teammate.
And those two, they're fighting for 12th place, Darrell, so they can't give way.
The spoiler is the 31 car. He's got tires on here. He comes out. He's going to get up in there and get in the way.
Oh, boy. Jeff Green, a quick pit stop for fuel.
Oh, she's got my heart rate's picked up, boys.
Oh, boy. Robbie Gordon underneath all the leaders, scoots through. Jarrett blockaded, drops to the bottom.
And here comes Kurt on the outside.
And Jack Sprague with fresh tires gets through.
And Kurt's going to get the lead back.
Yes, he is. Jack Sprague held up Dale Jarrett just enough that Kurt Busch gets back by.
And the 99, his teammate moved out of his way to give him room.
Sprague was faster on fresh tires.
Dale Jarrett's a little quicker than Kurt Busch. I don't know if he can get back around him or not.
Oh, loose
a little bit loose right there. Here they come to the line. Three laps to go. This time, side by side.
Dale Jarrett's got in position. He should have the best line down low. Forces Busch up a little bit. Got to stay off of him as they exit this turn. Kurt's been loose off of there.
They don't have a whole lot of lap traffic to contend with now. They'll become the two to go.
Now here's where Busch has been good on the high side.
Takes him high, pushes him up, tries to come in front of him, does.
Still there, clear high, clear
tries
high.
He did put the slide job on. He tried to cut back under him. Now we got a lap car in the way again.
Larry Foyt going past on fresher tires. A lap and a half.
What, either one of those guys to get for just half of a set of tires?
You know, Busch cut under Jarrett, but with Foyt there, there was no clean air to hold Busch's car down to the racetrack.
Yeah, Kurt's car just got too loose up off the corner, and Dale's car actually looks pretty good up off the corner.
Dale Jarrett went to the high side. White flag this time.
Yeah, he's got a little white flag.
Matt Kenseth closing.
Boy,
one to go.
Kenseth has come from way back. If he hadn't had to work through traffic, I think he would probably got the best car, but run out of time.
No lap cars to contend with, just went right up to the top of the racetrack, off turn four, final time.
And Dale Jarrett gets his 31st career Winston Cup victory, beating Kurt Busch by half a second.
Great race.
And Brad Parrott gets his first Winston Cup win as a crew chief. Won a lot of races as a crew chief for a Busch team. Jeff Burt, but he gets his first win. And trust me, Buddy Parrott, Todd Parrott are proud of Brad Parrott.
What's that feel like, Larry, to win your first race? I know what it feels like as a driver, but as a crew chief.
It's a wonderful feeling.
You've done your job.
It takes you a while to realize it, I think.
Yeah. You've done your job.
In Kurt Busch's last seven races, 3 wins, 2 seconds, a third, and a sixth.
Wow. And he will have the Winston Cup points leaving here.
Dale Jarrett has his 11th top five here in the last 15 starts and his second Rockingham victory. Let's join Dick Bergeron in Gatorade Victory Lane.
And this is going to be a very happy Victory Lane. Brad Parrott as crew chief wins his first 31st for Dale Jarrett as he climbs on the door. Can't climb on the, oh, the confetti, can't climb on the roof anymore. Well, you can sure celebrate. DJ, how hard did you have to fight Busch those last few laps to wind up here?
Well, we know what kind of competitor he is. Wasn't sure I was going to be able to get him. We'd both kind of worn our tires out, and I just got to say thanks to Brad Parrott, all the pit crew. They did a great job. To the 38 guys, they came down here and tested, and wouldn't have been for that, we wouldn't have had any idea really where to start with this. We had to make a lot of adjustments all day, but thanks to those guys for their help. Great teammates. Brad's first win. That was tough racing. I mean, you know, at a place where you're trying to get in the gas and your tires are worn out, this UPS Ford did the job. And I want to say thanks to Coca-Cola and Ford Credit for all they do. Let Zachary know, because of the winds this morning, he and Kelly couldn't fly down here. And so, Zach, whenever I get home, buddy, this trophy's yours. Sorry you couldn't be here. Hate the whole family. I'm going to brag for just a minute. I hope I got a couple of minutes. But Friday night, the Hickory girls varsity basketball team won their conference championship. They won the tournament. They won 23 straight games. My daughter Natalie is a freshman, plays on there. So congratulations to all of them. And the Hickory boys won the championship too. So it's been a big week for Hickory here. Had a lot of fun.
And congratulations to you.
Thank you a lot.
Natty.
Well, Dick, the season starts off just like it ended for Kurt Busch. Kurt, you were just commenting about how it just seems like the fall race and this race were so similar for you.
They ended the same way. This is a much more disappointing second than last week. We just burned the tires off a little bit. I don't know why. We're as good as we are for 60 laps. We just can't run that long stretch to 80 laps. So, you know, congratulations to Dale Jarrett. Classy guy, won the race today. It was a lot of fun racing him.
You guys were going back and forth.
Yeah, it was good stuff. I mean, I'm real proud of my team, the way we guessed for this setup. We changed four springs like we talked about earlier, and we kept the same shocks on it. We didn't know. There were so many things unknown, but the way that these guys built the car made this Ford run as well as it did. I'm real proud of the Rubbermaid team today.
Now, how excited are you going home to Las Vegas with this kind of momentum?
We're rolling good. Vegas, you know, it's a place that's been positive and negative for me. We've run real well, just never finished well. So I'm just looking for a top 10 finish, but it feels good to go back to Vegas.
Congratulations. Steve?
Thanks, Matty, with Matt Ketseth. Now, Matt, we heard you holler you thought you had a flat tire with about 10 to go.
Yeah, sometimes these tires, they wear and wear and wear, and then just all of a sudden they wear all the way out. So I must have had it more all the way out because it got real loose and was almost spinning out on me and getting into three. But, you know, I wish we were over there in Gatorade Victory Lane, but it was a great run for our whole DeWalt team. We had a good enough car to win all day. I felt like we just could never quite get there. Things just didn't quite work out where we could quite make it up front. And the last run, I thought we were going to have a run on because we were so strong at the end of the runs, but I had the car just a little too loose, and I used up a little bit too much tire, I think, trying to get by Rusty. So sometimes if you abuse them too much and are new, they don't last quite as good as you wish they would have been.
You guys did a great job adjusting all day. Matt, let's go to Jeannie Zelasco.
Conversation here, what? I had no gas left in the tank. Is that what he just said to you? Did you say that to him, Jamie McMurray?
No, we were just joking around a little bit about how slick it gets after a few laps on the tires, but really happy for everybody on the Haviland team. You know, Chip and Felix gave me an opportunity here last year, especially with the 40 car, and then this year, and Haviland took a chance on me, and I was a little nervous with it being a brand new team, but Donnie did a really good job in the pits today, made some calls and made some changes of stuff that I hadn't done before, and I didn't really know what was going to happen, but we kept up with the car all day, and I felt like the fact that it started out as a green racetrack, and, you know, the rubber got laid down, and we were able to keep up with that. That was really big. So glad for everybody. Happy for the whole Haviland Dodge team.
Congratulations. Mike?
Don't you love it when a wily veteran overcomes one of those, I hate to overuse the term, young guns?
Yeah, I do, but it makes such good TV. I mean, it's a great race. I don't care what anybody says. The young guy making the old guy get up on the wheel, man. And that's what these young drivers have done to the veterans. They've raised the bar, but a lot of them been able to answer. Mark Martin and Dale Jarrett today for sure, and plenty more guys back there, Ricky Rudd and some of the others, ready to challenge for the rest of the year.
Now, nothing against these young fellas. Kurt Busch was there all day, and did Jamie McMurray pour it on?
Well, I mean, that's the thing. We talked at the beginning of the show about the veterans in qualifying. We only had one young gun in the top 10, but I look at the top 10 now, Jamie McMurray, Kurt Busch, Jimmy Johnson, Elliott Sadler, who probably passed 150 cars today with all his problems. So the young guns, they kind of shined on race day.
I like the mix, Mike. I like the crew chiefs, the drivers. I like everything.
Well, Chris Myers, as you have a look at the final order of finish here from Rockingham, kind of leads us to say we can't wait for Vegas.
It was a terrific finish with Jeff Hammond here in the Hollywood Hotel. And as we check out the unofficial results of the Subway 400, Jeff, where did, in your opinion, Dale Jarrett win this race?
I think the communication between his crew, once again, he talked about Brad Parrott. Let's not forget that Todd Parrott was there with him, and all the communication with all of Yates Racing, they made the right adjustments and got that car to victory lane today.
All right, Chevy dominates at Daytona, but really a non-factor here. Only Jimmy Johnson, the only Chevy in the top 14, and little lead back of the pack.
Yeah, he's really struggling right now. This is exactly what this team didn't want. He finished 33rd today, 36th down at Daytona. This is not the way you want to start off the new season.
And where is Hendrick Motorsports after a couple of races with the names that we know, Jimmy Johnson and Jeff Gordon?
Yeah, we always expect these guys here to be up front. Now, you know, granted, they finished pretty well in the Daytona 500, but all day today, we never did really see these guys muscle up and get the job done what I thought they were going to do.
Kurt Busch, second at Daytona, second here today after putting on a nice battle towards the end, a duel at The Rock with Dale Jarrett. So these are the points after two races so far this season and heading to Las Vegas. What catches your attention is that is the first time for Kurt Busch that he has ever been the pointsman. Remember, he finished last year winning three of the last five races.
Yeah, I was his crew chief one time before. I felt like he had the talent and the desire to be a champion, and now he's already got his lead now in his point race. He may be hard to beat. You never know if they can get some consistency going this year.
And next weekend, the scene will shift to Las Vegas. Another full weekend of racing. Friday, the Busch Series qualifying on Speed, and then Winston Cup qualifying on Fox Sports Net. Saturday, NASCAR Busch Series racing presented by KFC. That's on FX, the pre-race show, followed by Winston Cup practice. Sunday, start your day with NASCAR this morning on Fox Sports Net. And then it's Winston Cup racing on Fox, the pre-race show. Note the later start, that's 2:30 Eastern time. And for Dale Jarrett, the 88 UPS car, his 31st career victory, second win at Rockingham, and the first win for crew chief Brad Parrott.
Yeah, that's a great feeling. Larry McReynolds talked about that. You always remember your first one. It's always important.
At the track that they've been racing since the mid-60s, The Rock, it proved to be an uphill battle. Rusty Wallace led for 182 laps. Dale Earnhardt Jr., problems all day, did not enjoy his Sunday ride. Kurt Busch put on a show, but in the end, the veteran, Dale Jarrett, leading for the first time with 10 laps to go, fighting off the 24-year-old Busch for the win. Next week, it's Viva Las Vegas. Thanks for watching NASCAR on Fox. We'll see you in Las Vegas next weekend.